The following is a presentation of ESPN on ABC.
Welcome to the Camping World Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Unexpected sellout crowd is still filing in to Camping World Stadium here in Orlando. An Irish invasion, a Cyclones invasion. It literally is a 50-50 split, and it will be a lot of fun to watch the first ever meeting between Iowa State and Notre Dame. The Irish have won 10 games in a season for the third straight year for the first time since 1991 through 1993, and they are looking for back-to-back 11-win seasons, as Brian Kelly believes a win today might propel them into the top 10 in the rankings to start next year. A terrific atmosphere here in Orlando as Brian Kelly set to lead the Irish onto the field here at Camping World Stadium. And here come the Fighting Irish. Ian Book, the Offensive Player of the Year for Notre Dame, 19-3, career as a starter. Can he get one more win this year? We'll find out. It has been a season that opened in the top 15 for the fourth time in the last 5 years for Notre Dame. Two ranked road losses, a tough one at Georgia, lopsided at Michigan, but on a five-game win streak to end the year. Can they make it six in a row? We're about to find out. Hi again, everyone. Bob Wischusen here with Dan Orlovsky. Allison Williams will join us down on the field in just a moment. This game's a big deal for this Notre Dame program, according to their head coach.
Absolutely. This is a chance to win 11 football games in a season. That would be the second year in a row. They haven't done that since 1989, right? And so not only the chance to win 11 games, but springing it into next year, two things. One, probably puts you in the top 10 or 12 in the preseason ranking. And Brian Kelly believes with so much of their talent coming back, this is a team that should be in the college football playoff conversation. So they are focused on winning this football game for today and also their future.
And they felt like they were close to being in that conversation earlier this season before a tough loss at Georgia and then going down at Michigan. As far as Iowa State is concerned, Dan, it's their third straight bowl game appearance. A terrific job done by the head coach, Matt Campbell. And they were a whisker away multiple times this season from defining wins.
Yeah, I mean, this is a really good five-loss football team. Five losses by 21 points. Those five losses four times had the lead or tied for it in the fourth quarter. Really well coached. A defense that schematically is very different. That'll challenge Notre Dame. Haven't seen something like that. And they got a good quarterback of their own. Brock Purdy's 3,500 yards and 35 touchdowns. So as good as Notre Dame's defense is, he's a really special and fine player out of the Big 12. This would be an awesome game today between the quarterbacks and defenses.
And Iowa State end the year with a win in their first ever meeting against Notre Dame. Well, it's a year that began with a top 25 ranking for the first time since 1978. Three of their losses by less than a field goal, but bowl eligible for the third straight season, only the second time in school history that the Cyclones have accomplished that. But Allison Williams down on the field. And Allison,
ladies, welcome to the 50-yard line. Tamara Ward, Chief Operating Officer of
Iowa State will be without their first team Big 12 left tackle, fifth-year senior Julian Good-Jones, out with a lower leg injury. He wanted to go, guys, but could not even dress for a warm-up. So his streak of 49 consecutive starts, a school record, will come to an end, and we have some shuffling up front. Josh Kniffel, the right guard, will go outside to left tackle. And their backup center, Colin Newell, will get the start at guard. Now, Newell was a starter to begin this season at center before getting injured, but definitely some pieces out of place for the Cyclones up front.
That's against a Notre Dame defense that was top 14 in opponents' points per game this year. It's Notre Dame and Iowa State. The Camping World Bowl will kick it off in a moment.
You're watching Capital One Bowl Mania.
Back in Orlando, of course, we are the appetizer. The main event comes up a little bit later on this afternoon. The college football playoff has finally arrived, and we get a chance to see, Dan, if Jalen Hurts and Oklahoma can do what no one thinks they can pull off, other than maybe inside their locker room against LSU and Joe Burrow.
Well, good thing for Oklahoma, they've got a guy who's done it in Jalen Hurts, and he's going to be impactful today because Joe Burrow's had such a special year. Obviously, the Heisman Trophy winner and the talent that he has on the outside. Jalen Hurts is going to have to stay on the field and make sure that they give limited opportunities to number 9 because he's such a special player.
Let's take a look at what's in store this postseason. Brought to you by Macy's. And it will be Oklahoma, LSU, and the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl at 4 over on ESPN and at 8 Eastern, the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. Clemson and Ohio State. And Allison, some news as far as LSU is concerned.
Yeah, their running back, Clyde Edwards-Helaire, is a game-time decision with a hamstring injury. But Ed Orgeron told Holly Rowe he is optimistic the running back will be able to play. He just doesn't know how much. And guys, this is huge because he is one of Joe Burrow's most trusted weapons and best friends.
Can't wait to watch those two games a little bit later on. And this is a very interesting game as well, as Notre Dame won the toss and they have elected to receive. The Camping World Bowl here in Orlando is underway. And it's Braden Lindsey. A couple of yards deep. He's going to bring it out. Gets out across the 20, close to the 22-yard line. So Ian Book, 19-3 in his career as a starter. And a guy that can hurt you through the air and on the ground.
Yeah, he's athletic in two different ways. Some designed quarterback runs and then some reactionary stuff. Listen, he is best when he's playing frantically, physically, but calm mentally. A challenge for a quarterback, but he's good enough. Bobby talked about it, 19-3 as a starter. New play caller today, an ex-Notre Dame quarterback, Tommy Reese. Be interesting to see how he helps his quarterback start this game.
The only five players that were more responsible for points this season than Ian Book: Joe Burrow, Jalen Hurts, Justin Fields, Anthony Gordon at Washington State, and Trevor Lawrence. And Tommy Reese calling plays today. Here's Tony Jones, and he has stood up after a gain of a couple. Well, Brian Kelly told us not only does it have to be some chunk plays through the air off play action, but you believe they have to be in between the safeties over the middle.
Yeah, they're going to give some opportunities. Iowa State defensively will give you some opportunities to throw the ball down the field in between those hashes. Now, it's got to have some air on it, but they're an aggressive secondary, and if you catch them in some play action stuff, there's some shots downfield for Ian Book.
Slipping and falling was Chase Claypool. So it's third down and a long 8, close to 9. What has to happen today for Ian Book to be successful?
The big thing for Ian Book is continue to see the string of the defense. Iowa State changes so much at that snap, and it's all connected. You don't have to do everything yourself. Trust some of those teammates around you. And Brian Kelly wants you to be a confident quarterback. You're the quarterback at the University of Notre Dame. That's the biggest thing. Have that persona for him, for Brian Kelly.
Play clock down
to
7.
Look at that pressure up there.
Iowa State shows blitz and a quick toss out to Armstrong. Tries to turn the corner and gets cut down well before picking up the first down. Braxton Lewis came up to make the stop for the Cyclone. So Iowa State forces a 3-and-out on Notre Dame's first possession.
And immediately you see Tommy Reese, the new play caller, go run. Tries to get a quick completion to Claypool, but then third down. Understanding Iowa State wants to bring some really unique pressures, making sure you don't do anything risky early on with the football. A run out there. Credit Iowa State for the look and then forcing that tackle.
Jay Bramlett will kick it away to Tariq Milton. Line drive, returnable for Milton from the 35. The ball's ripped out, and it looks like Notre Dame's got it. And it's Claypool. Comes up with the fumble recovery. Alohi Gilman ripped it away from Tariq Milton. and a special teams takeaway for the Irish to open up.
See the return by Milton, the spin, and then the effort by Gilman to strip that ball out. Remember, special teams hasn't been live in practice for either teams. Strong rip at the ball by Gilman, the safety. Massive swing of events early on. Now let's see if Notre Dame can capitalize.
Jet sweep to Lindsey. Stiff arm. And he's out of bounds inside the 35-yard line. Notre Dame, Dan, has feasted off of takeaways this season. Probably their most impressive team individual statistic.
Well, one, it's been fumbles, which is a big part. Forced fumbles out of their football team, and it's something that Clark Lee, their defensive coordinator, and their coaching staff, they focus on it. You saw it right there with Gilman, the effort to rip that football, not necessarily going at it, but actually try to grab a hold of it, grab a point and rip it out. Great strength there, and it's something they focus all the time.
Armstrong. Just a shade shy of the first down, so it will be third down and about a half yard. Yoma Iwazurike made the stop, and it's third down and less than one.
And this should be another run for Notre Dame. This is absolutely four down territory coming off of that turnover.
Same play. Same result. Armstrong dropped well behind the line. Now is it four down territory? Because now it looks like it's fourth down and about four.
And we talked about new play caller, Tommy Rees. You could be very confident going into a football game, but this is a big moment. I don't love the play call because it's going side to side. I would have loved to seen someone right at this Iowa State defense, allowing this Notre Dame offensive line to get some energy going on. Great job by Iowa State running sideline to sideline. This ball should start at number 83. Chase Claypool right here. Last time Iowa State on third down blitzed everybody. I expect them to drop out in zone coverage.
Going for it on fourth and five with the play clock winding down. Book out of the pocket. No one on the edge to contain him, and Ian Book's got the first down on a fourth down scramble.
Well, we talked about it before the game when it came to Ian Book. Sometimes designed run, sometimes reactionary. Wants to go to Claypool. It's not there. Just watch the reaction. Up in the pocket, dip out, and then get on one of those edges. That is great instincts by Ian Book. Reactionary quarterback play by him. And that's a really big moment on that fourth down conversion.
And the right guard, Trevor Ruland, pancaked a couple of Cyclones. There's Tony Jones with a cutback. Flag down. Picked up two. Greg Eisworth made the stop for the Cyclones.
Holding number 84 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay, first down.
Let's watch the tight end number, the 84 right there, Cole Kmet. Outside release, and then that right arm. Mike Rose got inside of him and that right arm tugged down. Actually looked like there was a holding on the third down beforehand. Cole Kmet just got out of control there on that big outside release.
Screen out to Fink. Gets a block and makes a man miss. And is inside the 35 down to the 34-yard line. Jamal Johnson brings him down after only a gain of three. So second down and 17.
Iowa State doing a really good job right now defensively of running to the football. Something that Notre Dame needs to dial up quickly here is a screen to slow down all that effort.
Play action. The blitz picked up. Book nowhere to throw the football though. And fires it over the head of Claypool and out of bounds. So now it's third down and 17.
Missed one there. Had Tommy Tremble down that seam against Iowa State's cover three. No, third down here. Initially play call, you're thinking unlikely to go get 17 yards. So I really want to get 7 or 8 yards here and give me a chance at least have the conversation for a field goal. Initially went to Claypool. This is Cole Kmet right here. Really good tight end, one of the country's best.
Book with a check down. Claypool crossing the middle, looking for the first down marker. And now another decision for Notre Dame to make. Now it's fourth down and four once again, knocking on the door of the red zone at the Iowa State 21-yard line to pick up the 13.
They go with the screen pass to Claypool, and really good job front side with those blocks. And Claypool sees some vision, and if he just follows Tony Jones and slips inside of him right there, he might be able to lunge towards that first down. But really good play call by Tommy Reese right there, understanding the situation, getting something, and giving this a legit field goal chance for Dorr.
So Jonathan Dorr from 39 yards out to try and get the Irish on the board first, and net three off the special teams takeaway. And he's got it. Notre Dame takes the early lead here at the Camping World Bowl in Orlando. The college football playoff semifinals today on ESPN and the ESPN app. Heisman winner Joe Burrow, number one LSU, take on Oklahoma in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl. And then at 4 Eastern, number two and number three, Ohio State Clemson in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. The winners, of course, play for the national championship Monday, January 13th on ESPN. And be sure to check out the Xfinity SkyCam broadcast of our game streaming now on the ESPN app and ESPN3. Returnable kick for Vene Nwangu, and he'll call for the fair catch, bring it out to the 25-yard line. So our first opportunity to see Brock Purdy, who's 11-5 in his career in the league, against the Big 12, and he's an impressive player.
He's an outstanding young quarterback, has a chance to be one of the great college quarterbacks in the country next year. He's probably best when it's a little bit more recess football than structured football. The big thing for him today is making sure he doesn't get his fundamentals all over the place and plays good sound football and just reacts like we saw Ian Book do on that third down.
They're going to go empty, but bring the true freshman Breece Hall into the backfield on first down. And they'll run it with Hall, and he will find room right up the middle into the secondary and spins out to midfield. 23-yard pickup on the opening play for Breece Hall.
This is outstanding. Watch 66 Kniffel pull around the left tackle. Look at that hole right there for Breece Hall. He's a young, exciting back. Very good vision and speed. That's an outstanding start for this Iowa State run game.
Notre Dame has allowed 3.7 points per game in the opening quarter. They have pitched 6 first quarter shutouts. So normally they are stingy to open the game. A little option pitch here to Hall. And this time he's brought down, maybe picked up a half yard. Jameer Jones gets the stop right at the line of scrimmage. And the keys for Iowa State today, most importantly, spread things around.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the kind of the nature of their offense. Notre Dame's secondary is very good. They don't give up a lot of big passing. So make sure you're playing. Brock Purdy's got to play point guard. Distribute the football a bunch to everybody around him, making sure everybody's getting touches, and then forcing Notre Dame to tackle really well out in space.
Number 8 in the foreground is DeShonte Jones. He's had 4 100-yard games this season, and there he goes in motion. Hall in the flat, makes a man miss, spins into plus territory. He's got 5. It'll be 3rd down and 5.
For Brock Purdy today, really making sure that what he sees is tied into his feet, you know, not getting all over the place. Get the ball out of your hands on early downs, let those guys work. And then the short passes, which has really been a big staple of their offense, the short stuff, allow those guys to make big plays down the field after yards after catch.
Purdy, slant over the middle for a first down. DeShonte Jones with his first catch. And it's good to move the chains to the Irish 36.
Outstanding design for Iowa State offensively. Just a bunch concept, really good patience by Deshaunte Jones.
Play action again. Purdy extending the play. Lost the football. It's another takeaway for Notre Dame. Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah comes up with the recovery as Purdy coughs it up.
Look at the play by Owusu-Koramoah. Brock Purdy's trying to make something happen. I talked about the recess football. Punch at it, effort to go recover. Notre Dame, two turnovers early on.
The Camping World Bowl on ABC is brought to you by Camping World, making RVing fun and easy since 1966. And in part by Capital One, what's in your wallet?
Dan Orlovsky-esque speed to the pylon. That's what we saw pregame.
That kid's faster.
That is the nimble, fleet of foot, Dan Orlovsky. I am the media buffet connoisseur, Bob Bischusen. Allison Williams, who classes all of us up, thankfully, is down on the field. And got to stop coughing the ball up if you're Iowa State. Two giveaways, great field position again for the Irish.
Absolutely, and you're going to see Notre Dame in this drive get under center a little bit. This is going to be a big thing for today in their run game.
Tony Jones down the sideline. And a chunk play in the run game for the Irish. 26 yards.
So well designed. They run behind their two tight ends, Tremble and Cole Kmet on the right side. You see Kmet kick out. Watch Tremble up on a corner. Go find some work, big fella. Big offensive gain for Notre Dame running the football. That's what they want to be today. Let's get back to running the football under center, downhill. This should be the theme of this game.
Book, long throw to Fink outside the numbers. He's got about 5 yards.
Guys, Notre Dame with two early fumble recoveries. Like all teams, they're always working the turnover circuit, but they really try to adapt the drills to keep it fresh and really harp attention to detail. They're constantly telling their guys tip, tuck, squeeze. They want them to cradle the football with both hands, grabbing it on the tip, bringing it into their chest to squeeze it, and into their knees to pin it. So also harping, do not roll over with the football, and it's that attention to detail that has helped them have so much success this year with the fumble recoveries.
Tony Jones breaks a tackle, and he's about a yard shy of the first down. It was a point Brian Kelly made to us yesterday that you don't just jump on the football the way a lot of people think you might jump on the football when it's loose on the ground. We actually teach a technique once you jump on the football to make sure that we get it.
Well, I think a lot of programs try and do that. The thing that was interesting with Notre Dame is how they changed about going teaching their players, how they practice it, all those things to continue to keep it fresh. And again, they're 28 turnovers on the year this year in their takeaways.
Third down, Jones up the middle, and now it's going to be fourth down. He's shy by about a yard. Fourth and one, just shy of the 22-yard line. Iwazurike made the stop again for the Cyclones. So can Iowa State hold once again on their half of the field?
Iowa State has got such a great advantage here because Ray Lehman, number 58, is at the center of their point right here. He's a big-time nose tackle. This ball should be downhill.
Book, quarterback sneak. And it looks like he got there. Iowa State thinks they have him stopped, but both officials running right down the line to gain. Let's see where they spot it.
This was really cool. We talked about Tommy Reese and his first time calling plays. Watch Brian Kelly's lips here. This is third down. Think about fourth down. That's great communication from a head coach to a play caller. Hey, I'm giving you credence here. Make this play call knowing I'm more than likely going to go for this on fourth down. You saw Tommy Reese go run, 3 or 4 yard gain, and then they get that quarterback sneak. I love that from Brian Kelly. That's empowering your play caller.
It is a Notre Dame first down. Well, Tommy Reese calling the play is not yet 30 years old. So Brian Kelly made the decision about 2.5 weeks ago to let go of offensive coordinator Chip Long. Why and what impact is he hoping it's going to have today and going forward?
I think the biggest thing is Brian Kelly wants to regain the identity of Notre Dame football as a run-first football team. You know, Ian Book is their second leading rusher in yards and attempts. that's not long-term success for this program. They're an offensive line-based program that can run the football. So he wants to run it more, be committed to it. And then I truly believe he wants Tommy Rees to be their future play caller. He believes in him, and he wanted him to give him his first chance.
Lindsay on the jet sweep picked up a couple. And Notre Dame did not have a running back this season average better than 70 yards per game. Today, already, Tony Jones has 31 yards, and we still have 4.5 minutes to go in the first quarter.
When I go back to that third down play call, think of it, he's an ex-quarterback, and probably, hey, think about fourth down. So many people might think quarterback's going to throw the football. He ran it. That tells you his what he wants his identity to be.
Draw play. Jones up the middle. A yard and a half. So now a third down in the red zone for Notre Dame. Pretty simple for Notre Dame. In their losses this season, Georgia, Michigan barely ran the ball at all, at least with no effect, but when they won, they averaged better than 5 yards per carry, and now it's third down at 7.
You're never going to see, or Notre Dame's not going to see the same thing twice in a row from Iowa State's defense. Bunch of different looks.
Flag down. Looks like the Irish may have flinched.
Definitely a false start. It looked like both tackles for Notre Dame jumped.
This is a long discussion before a false start call. Let's see what they come away with. False start calls are usually pretty cut and dry. This one obviously is not.
False start, 74 on the offense, 5 yard penalty, third down.
Sure what the holdup was. That seemed like a pretty obvious boost to the feet by Eichenberg.
Yeah, 74 Eichenberg right there during the motion of Fink. Watch his left foot just hop back, anticipating some kind of pressure from Iowa State.
He knew it. Third down and 12 now.
Look at Ian Book right now. Look into the sideline. The big thing is Brian Kelly and Tommy Rees trying to seize things that Iowa State's defense is going to do and getting on the same page play call wise.
Takes a shot for Claypool at the pylon. Climbs the ladder. Is he in? Yes! It's a Notre Dame touchdown.
A little bit of a turkey hole shot right here from Book to Claypool. Rise up, get that left foot down. You see that athleticism by the big fella. Beautiful eyes by Ian Book. Hold the safety. Big high ball to the 6 foot Claypool. Got the right elbow and the left foot down. That's good on Sundays. Big time touchdown for Notre Dame.
13th touchdown reception this season for Chase Claypool. And now 34 touchdown passes against only 6 interceptions for Ian Book. And that was a pretty one.
Love the aggressive play call by Notre Dame. Find the safety, hold my eyes, throw this ball up high to 6'4 footer. Big time catch by Claypool. Notre Dame, 10-0.
I may wax poetic just a bit to see if there's something I can add. I hear it. Memphis has the early lead in Dallas. Notre Dame has the early 10-0 lead here in Orlando. The Camping World Bowl, Bob Wischusen alongside Dan Orlovsky. Allison Williams is with us as well. Nwangu, this time he's going to run it out from inside the 5. And gets brought down at about the 22-yard line. As we take a look at today's PlayStation player impact rating. And Dan, what we do with the help of PlayStation is graph every player on a scale of 0 to 100 and how significant we believe their impact is going to be on the game. And Ian Book and Brock Purdy, they're going to heavily impact the game.
Yeah, and it's really the importance, and it kind of factors in who they're playing with and also who they're playing against and how important they are compared to somebody if they were being replaced that was an average player. So you can see both Brock Purdy and Ian Book tremendously impactful above the quarterback position for their teams.
Breece Hall. Jitterbugs out to the 25-yard line and picks up three.
I also loved PlayStation as a kid. You didn't play PlayStation probably because you're a little older than me, but PlayStation and the video game Twisted Metal made my childhood.
You didn't play Pong?
No, I'm not.
Breakout on Pong was just a tremendous game.
You probably grew up on Atari, huh?
I was already a teenager when they came out with Atari. That's not true. Not that old. Breece Hall again. Stuffed at the line. Met by Drew White.
Guys, as people at home watch Brock Purdy, see if he reminds you of a former Big 12 quarterback, Baker Mayfield. In fact, Matt Campbell said when he first watched Purdy's high school film, the quarterback that came to mind was Baker Mayfield. And it's not just his skill set, his ability to thrive in what Dan calls like that recess football. He said it was the intangibles, the it factor, how he always had control of the offense. He even went and watched Mayfield's high school film, and he said it was uncanny how similar the two were. We know what a competitor Mayfield is. He said Purdy is the biggest competitor he's been around.
Has a rifle shot to LaMichael Petway on third down and gets a first down, a gain of 15, out to the 40. And even in that recess football world that Brock Purdy seems to excel in the Baker Mayfield world, they're still worried about his fundamentals.
Yeah, because when he gets chaotic or when things around him get chaotic and his fundamentals start to slip, that's when he can turn the football over like we saw or whatnot. So it's a fine line. Like, you want him to be him, but you also want to make sure that he's as refined as possible in that spectrum. Right there, that third down conversion was big time to Petway. Stared at the rush. I know you're coming. It's man coverage. Get the ball out. Big time completion.
Play action. Purdy back shoulder down the sideline. LaMichael Petway. Did he get a foot down? He did at the Irish 42. It's a gain of 18 more.
That's so well done by Brock Purdy again. And watch Petway. Okay, win, climb, get my head back. Ball's behind me. Locate it. Hands catch and then toe tap on the sideline. That's big way. The transfer has come over and had a really big year. 50-plus catches. You see the size at 220 pounds. Back-to-back big completions.
Rad transfer from Arkansas that led the Razorbacks last year with 30 catches. Back to the ground in Breece Hall. Brought down right at the line of scrimmage, maybe a loss of a half yard. Asmar Bilal came up to make the stop for the Irish.
You're going to see Notre Dame defensively. This is who they are. They are going to commit people to the line of scrimmage to make sure you're never at a numbers advantage for your run game. Now, they protect themselves in the pass game. They're aware. Clark Lee, their defensive coordinator, will drop a guy here, drop a guy there. But they're going to commit to showing you seven or eight guys in the box. They trust their corners that are very good and force you to think that you're one-dimensional.
Well, it should be the final play of the quarter. Play action. Purdy over the middle. That's knocked down by Troy Pride. And that will take us to the end of the first quarter. Sean Shaw looking for a flag. And Pride got the right hand in and was able to get the pass defensed. Purdy's first incompletion takes us to the end of the first quarter.
Big time play by Pride. This Notre Dame defense playing really well. Iowa State on a little bit of a drive. Protect the football. You got something going against this Notre Dame defense.
ESPN, home of the college football playoff.
Welcome back to the Camping World Bowl, all part of Capital One Bowl Mania here in Orlando. Happy holidays. Hopefully everyone had a happy and healthy Christmas. Iowa State fans are known to invade, and obviously there are Notre Dame fans everywhere. So a crowd enjoying a start for Notre Dame. Well, they've got 10 points off turnovers. Second quarter begins, 3rd and 10 for the Cyclones. Four-man rush. Purdy out of the pocket. Reverses field. Gets a block. Looking downfield, he wants it off. Tariq Milton, and that floats out of bounds. And now it's 4th down and 10 at the 42-yard line.
Outstanding job initially by Purdy getting out of the pocket. I thought he had Milton sooner if he throws it down the field. Just loses control of the ball, and this is probably a punt now for Iowa State. Try to pin Notre Dame back.
What do you think that quarterback conversation is? Have you been in those? Do you ever have one of those?
That's a lot calmer than the ones that I was a part of. What are you doing? I don't know.
Joe Rivera with the intentional end-over-end kick trying to pin the Irish deep. And spins it back inside the 10-yard line. Well done by Joe Rivera, the punter for the Cyclones. So Notre Dame has a 10-point lead in the long field out in front of them. We come back to Orlando. We return with a look at our Expedia Drive recap. And Dan, the last time Notre Dame had the football, it was off their second takeaway, and they put it in the end zone.
Absolutely, you saw the fumble, then it started with the run. Really good job front side by both their tight ends, Tremble and Cole Kmet. You saw the 4th down conversion, Ian Book on the quarterback sneak, and then 3rd down, great job by his eyes. High ball to Chase Claypool. Big time touchdown on 3rd and long for this Notre Dame offense. They've done a good job both times getting turnovers and getting points. 1 field goal, 1 touchdown.
Tony Jones moves the pile for about 2.5 yards.
Keep an eye on any adjustments for the Iowa State defense. They really kind of take that first quarter to see how opponents play them. They told us yesterday they don't have a lot of cheat film, is what they call it, because nobody else runs what they do defensively. So after the first quarter, they really have to reassess and change some things, dial some things in defensively once they have a better idea of how the opposing offense is going to play them.
Keeper for Book. Gets outside. Stays in bounds and picks up a 1st down. And it's a great point by Allison. Getting ready for this game, watching Iowa State on film, what do they play defensively? How would you categorize
it? Well, everyone thinks it's a 3-3-5. I actually think it's a 3-5-3. Those 5 secondary or second-level players are sometimes safeties, sometimes backers. All 8 of them are going to be near the line of scrimmage. And they will blitz anybody from anywhere in different locations, starting point and ending point. And so it's a very unique thing. And then obviously a safety in the middle of the field can sometimes be at 10 yards, sometimes they're at 6 yards, sometimes they're at 4 yards. So to Allison's point, it's very different. And the big thing is you can't chase ghosts against them. You can't go up. You kind of have to play as the game goes on and make your adjustments.
Bowl Mania rolls on Monday. 2 more games on ESPN and the ESPN app. Western Kentucky and Western Michigan square off in the Serve Pro First Responder Bowl at 12:30 Eastern. And Kylan Hill and Mississippi State take on Scott Satterfield's Louisville Cardinals in the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl. As Ian Book almost picked off, Marcel Spears laying in wait at about the 32-yard line. Got a hand on the football and forces 3rd down and long.
If Spears didn't get it, Anthony Johnson was going to, coming from the outside and into the corner. It's great reaction by Ian Book. Watch Spears right there. Just get that left hand up there, and you see 26 Anthony Johnson coming in from the right side. Book knows, all right, I got away with one there. Spinning it to 3rd down. Last time Iowa State played some soft zone. You see the bunch by Notre Dame. I expect pressure and man coverage against Notre Dame here.
They're bringing a blitz this time. Book, long throw right at the 1st down line to gain. The catch is made, but that's going to be short. Lindsey is driven back by Tavon Kyle. It's going to be 4th down and 1. Good one-on-one tackle by Kyle.
And I really like the job that Tommy Reese is doing as a play caller, but he's going to have to be willing at some point to throw this football down the field, because Iowa State on 1st, 2nd, and 3rd down, those secondary players, really their safeties, are coming out of the middle of the field quickly. That's the 2nd time they played 0 blitz on 3rd down, meaning everyone's blitzing, no one deep, and playing man-to-man coverage. The ball is going to have to go downfield today for Notre Dame to really score the points that they want to.
Tariq Milton fumbled on his only opportunity in the 1st quarter. This one returnable, and this time he goes down with no return yardage after a 37-yard punt. Iowa State football, when we come back.
Let's bring the energy and the focus, all right? Energy and focus, and let's get better today.
When you guys flying around, we got to be physical.
Love the physicality and competitiveness. Okay, let's channel that in to doing the right thing, taking care of one another. Everybody good with that?
Best thing is, I know about this football team, you're going to respond. I know you will. You'll do anything we ask you to. Anything we demand you to do it, I know you will.
Sooners on three, one, two, three.
All in on three, one, two, three.
All out on three, one, two, three.
All out.
All access inside the college football playoff, now streaming on ESPN Plus. And the two college football playoff games later on today. We've got fans of both teams here in Orlando. Good field position for Iowa State. Purdy flips one to a wide open Breece Hall down the sideline. Spins inside the 40. Down to the Fighting Irish 38-yard line. Kyle Hamilton might have been the last man between Breece Hall and the end zone.
Outstanding play design. They brought the motion from one side to the other, and then they bring Breece Hall from that same side back from where the motion started. Notre Dame playing man defense. Eyes were in the wrong spot. Huge gain on first down for Iowa State.
Sheldon Crony right up the middle for three.
Guys, we saw a little bit of that Clemson all-access piece, and Matt Campbell and his staff had an all-access pass to Clemson in the offseason. They went and visited the Tigers, and Campbell told me he was just so impressed with Coach Sweeney and how everything was so aligned throughout that entire program. But here's what's interesting. The Tigers coaching staff actually made the trip out to Ames as well. Brent Venables, their defensive coordinator, and his entire defensive staff came out to watch Iowa State and learn a little bit about their unique defense and what they do. So the national champs actually coming out and visiting the Cyclones.
Hall back in the game, breaks a tackle, he's got a first down. Now, what does that tell you about the national perspective? Top teams in college football recognizing about Matt Campbell and his staff.
A ton of respect for Matt Campbell as a coach, understanding that they're doing some things schematically different that make it challenging for teams, ways to be different, ways to not do the same thing that everybody in America is doing. And so, listen, for everyone who doesn't follow Iowa State intimately, this is a really good program, really well coached, and everybody college football-wise in the country recognizes it.
Purdy for the pump fake. He's going to take a shot towards the end zone to Petway. Climbs the ladder. Incomplete. Charred free at the last moment. Tariq Bracey was there in coverage.
Really good job by Petway being physical down the field. And then a big ball by Purdy. This is in the right place, perfect location. Credit Bracey for going through the catch. You saw the right arm get in there. Through the catch to break that ball. Petway's a big 6'2", 220-pounder. Look at the right arm get in there. Fight. That's called poise as a defensive back. Fight through the catch. Outstanding job by Bracey.
Keep our eyes on the Irish sideline as well. As you saw earlier, they are without Khalid Kareem, their senior defensive end, their defensive player of the year. And now Iowa State will use a timeout. We'll step aside for just a moment as well. Notre Dame with the 10-0 lead here in Orlando.
The Camping World Bowl on ABC is brought to you by Camping World, making RVing fun and easy since 1966.
A lot of different ways to have fun in Orlando. And both teams hosted local Orlando youth at an outing at Andretti's. Played games, enjoyed their time, they've enjoyed their week. It's the first ever football meeting between Iowa State And Notre Dame, the Camping World Bowl, Bob Wischusen, Dan Orlovsky, Allison Williams. All 10 points for the Irish off of turnovers. And Khalid Kareem back on the field for second down and 10. Hand off to Hall. Inside the 25, down to about the 24-yard line for a couple of yards. So it'll be third down and 8 for the Irish. And neither team seems to have targeted their big-time tight ends yet. Does that surprise you?
Absolutely, especially for Iowa State. I mean, Charlie Kohler is really the part of their offense that they build so much through. And he's such a mismatch at 6'6" and very smart. Now, Notre Dame has done a good job. They put Kyle Hamilton on him, who's a 6'4 safety. But Kohler's got to get some touches going in this game for this Iowa State offense, really on third downs, to be successful.
Kohler just looked over to the sideline. He's going to stay in pass protection here as Purdy's going to throw one up and away over the head of DeShonte Jones. And now it's fourth down and 8. From right here, it'll be about a 42-yard field goal. And it looks like Matt Campbell's going to send Connor Rasali out to try exactly that.
And right now for Notre Dame, Clark Lee, their defensive coordinator, is winning. He's winning. He's showing some different looks. You think it's zone, I'm going to play man. You think it's man, I'm going to play zone. Different kinds of man where they'll have a player in the middle field taking some of those crossing routes out. Clark Lee is doing a really good job of taking away what Iowa State wants to do initially.
This will be from 41. And that's right down the middle. So the Cyclones get on the board. 9:27 to go before halftime. Notre Dame's lead cut down to a touchdown. LSU in Oklahoma at 4 Eastern on ESPN kicks off the college football playoff with the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl. And then I think you and I both like Clemson in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl later on tonight at 8 Eastern on ESPN. It's finally here. The college football playoff should be two good games.
I'm excited to watch Burrow play, obviously. I mean, he's had such a monster year. Just the fun that it looks like he's having at quarterback. Their receivers are the best receiving core in the country, with all due respect to Clemson and Alabama. And then obviously having the chance to watch Clemson play tonight will be really fun and exciting, because there's been a lot of conversation about that football team nationally, and I'm a big believer in them, and so be a blast.
You ever remember the wide receiver position specifically being this good and this deep in college football? This could be a monster wide receiver draft in the NFL.
Teams in the NFL are like, we don't have to reach. We don't have to go get them in the first round. There's going to be really good players in the second and third round taken at that position.
Lindsey at the 6. Like lightning up the sideline. Lowers his shoulders out across the 30. And banged out of bounds just shy of the 35-yard line. They'll mark him out right about at the 35. It's a good field position for the Irish.
Bob, there may be some Iowa State fans who are cheering for LSU today, and here's why. Their quarterback, Joe Burrow, was actually born in Ames, Iowa. His dad, Jim, was a football coach at Ames High School and an assistant at Iowa State. So Joe was born there. He lived there until he was 4 years old. Now, obviously, he doesn't remember a whole lot about it, as Jim said. He said he did go to Ames High School games, though, when he was just a few days old, back when Jim was coaching there. So kind of a cool connection between Joe Burrow and the Cyclones fans.
Ian Book off play action. He's going to float one to the sideline for Claypool. Drops it in. The second big play between Ian Book and Chase Claypool. And the Irish in business, a gain of 32.
Great trust by Ian Book. Look at this ball come out of his hand now. And Claypool has just started to make his angle. Part of that reason is because you can go trust that 6'4 receiver to go up and make that catch. That's that same look last drive that Notre Dame ran the football on and said they got to take their shot downfield. There it is.
Now they play with some tempo. An end around on the flip to Fink. And a trick play bottled up by Iowa State. They were ready for it. It's a loss of about 5.
It's actually a really good play by Fink. I love aggressive play calls. I love creative ones. So I love to see that out of Brian Kelly and Tommy Reese. But you tell that receiver there in that moment, listen, if it's not perfectly clear to you, we got other plays. Don't force it. Really good job by Fink understanding that. The veteran experience just as football-wise there. Good job not taking a bad play and making it worse. Wish I could teach that to some quarterbacks. Mainly myself 20 years ago.
Wheel route broken up. Marcel Spears knocked it away from Tony Jones. It'll be third down and 15. And Marcel Spears, a fifth-year senior, he and Ray Lima on that defensive line. Boy, Matt Campbell and John Heacock, the defensive coordinator, went on and on about those two guys. That was the pair that, when they first were brought, had to buy in and believe in their culture and kind of have blind faith, and they did. Here they are.
Coaches set culture, players apply it, and Marcel Spears has done that at Iowa State.
Iowa State dials up a blitz. Ian Book flips it to the sideline. The catch is made by Jafar Armstrong, but stepped out of bounds right at the original line of scrimmage, a gain of five. So now you've got fourth down and 10. And this is a long field goal attempt that it looks like Brian Kelly is going to send Jonathan Doerr out to attempt. He's got range from 50 plus. He made a 52-yarder. His career long earlier this season against USC. That's the third longest field goal in Notre Dame history. This one from 51.
Watch the left side. Notre Dame got pushed last field goal attempt. Watch the left side and a low kick.
And it is a low kick, a knuckleball, but it finds its way through. It's not how, it's how many. And he knocked it through.
No pictures in box scores, right?
That's it.
Big kick by Doerr. Get Notre Dame up. 13-3.
Wow.
Wow.
Just not nice. New Year's Eve, we'll have three more bowl games for you on ESPN and the ESPN app. Virginia Tech's longtime defensive coordinator Bud Foster with a tough test in his final game. It's the Hokies in Kentucky in the Belk Bowl at noon. Then Navy, Kansas State in the AutoZone Liberty Bowl. And at 7:30, the Valero Alamo Bowl. Number 11, Utah and Texas. Great time of year to be a college football fan, and this might be the best day of them all. Here at the Camping World Bowl, Bob Wischusen, Dan Orlovsky, Allison Williams, and a touchback here for Iowa State. And this season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's general scholarship fund. Thank you to Allstate. It's Florida. Sometimes it rains. And we were expecting some rain showers at some point during the afternoon here, and it looks like one is starting to come through the Camping World Stadium area. So now Brock Purdy and Iowa State goes to work with a wet football to worry about. Although the kicking tee was left on the field by the Fighting Irish, so they've got to get that off the field. And now Brock Purdy set to go to work midway through the second quarter. Four-man rush. Purdy out of the pocket, up the middle, slides, and he'll be marked down at about the 28-yard line. Did he get bumped as he went down, as Mar Bilal was there to force him into the slide for Notre Dame?
Man, you never like to see this for a quarterback get up and holding something in that upper body. See him just get up and kind of hold that left shoulder, that left chest area. Hopefully it's nothing.
Brees Hall on second down. And it's going to be third down and 3 at the 32-yard line. Another tackle for Bilal.
I think if you're Iowa State, seeing that it's third and 3, anticipating some kind of man coverage, they love to run shallows no matter the down, but they're going to have to help some of those shallows here. So condense some splits. Get those guys splits down closer to the line of scrimmage. I love this. And then try to get some picks, some rubs for these receivers against man.
Again, a four-man rush. Purdy buying time. Tucks it under. He's going to try and run for the first down, and it looks like he's got it. Kyle Hamilton was there to force him out. But Purdy picked up the four that he needed.
You probably see there one of Brock Purdy's greatest assets or characteristics is his competitiveness, his feel, his football instincts. Gets out of the pocket, nothing's there, and he just a little pump fake got Kyle Hamilton, the Notre Dame safety, hold for a second, and that hesitation gets that extra yard, yard and a half that Brock Purdy needed. I think they got to run the football weak here. They should be running this football out here. There's numbers there for their offense and leverage.
All again. Looking for a cutback lane, and there's nothing there. Shut down right at the line of scrimmage. Again, it's Bilal. That was there to help on the stop for Notre Dame. That's a loss of one. Coming up at the half, I'll check in with Matt Barry, Joey Galloway, and Jesse Palmer. The Mercedes-Benz halftime report. We'll update the first half at the Goodyear Cotton Bowl. Highlights of our game as well. And of course, we will preview the college football playoff semifinals beginning at 4 Eastern on ESPN. Notre Dame brings a blitz. Unable to make the one-handed catch is Breece Hall. So now it's third down and 11 as the rain continues to fall here in Orlando.
Yeah, and one thing you guys will see with this Notre Dame defense is they're going to rotate a ton of guys up front on that D-line. They'll play about 10 guys there. And Mike Elson was telling his guys, we're going to rotate you in, so we need you running on and off the field and constantly running to the football. No reason not to, because we're going to make sure you stay fresh.
And Brock Purdy has missed on 5 of his last 6 passing attempts.
Got to get something working high to low here. Put a linebacker in a bind.
Purdy right at the first down line to gain. It's the first catch for Kohler. Where will they mark the football? It might be fourth down and inches near midfield. Kohler thought he picked up the first down. Yeah, they're going to say without measurement it's fourth down. And now a decision to make for Matt Campbell on his side of the 50.
Big time throw by Brock Purdy. This is a big decision for Matt Campbell. I think he's going to go for it. I mean, you need half a yard, if that. You got a fifth-year center, Colin Olsen, at leading the point for you. Zone read, something going downhill at this Notre Dame defense off the left side.
Timeout call. Iowa State wants to talk it over. A decision to make for Matt Campbell. They're going to talk things over. 4 minutes to go before halftime. A 10-point lead for Notre Dame over Iowa State. Would you make this decision in a regular season game the same way you might make it in the bowl game? You're giving your team a chance maybe in a postseason game that doesn't have the regular season ramifications of what if you fail?
I love the call. I mean, probably not in the regular season. But this team needs a little juice right now, especially offensively. One thing I would not do is be in the shotgun. I would put Brock Purdy under center. I know their left tackle's not out, but you need a foot. You got a fifth-year center at kind of leading the point, running the football for you. So I wouldn't put him in the shotgun. I'd go quarterback sneak underneath and tell him pick the softer guard either side.
Well, they're in the shotgun after the timeout. Fourth down and inches. And now a timeout called by Notre Dame on defense before the snap. It's almost like a basketball game, right? Want to come out, see what they're in, and talk it over themselves.
Seemed to be some miscommunication. You look at the face of Brian Kelly, not happy about something. And if Notre Dame is going to line up in the look that they were just in, you can go off between the center and the left guard. You can run quarterback sneak and easily get a full yard. So I think they need to go under center and run quarterback sneak unless Notre Dame puts both guys in between the center and the guard.
You know what would be nice on fourth down and one? If you had that guy. Right? If you could just give it to him, and we're going to see Clemson give it to Travis Etienne a lot later on tonight against Ohio State in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl.
You mean the hardest tailback in the country to tackle?
He only averages about 8.1 per carry.
And probably 6 of them come after first contact.
His jersey even shows up at the Camping World Bowl. So after both teams have called timeouts, fourth down and less than a foot. Breece Hall right up the middle, and he is stuffed behind the line. Not even close. Notre Dame, they've already taken the ball away twice with turnovers, one on special teams and one by their defense, and now their defense gets a turnover on downs.
Outstanding penetration. Watch 95 on the left. Tungavailoa-Amosa. Right in between the guard and the center there with that penetration. Notre Dame stunted. Brought both defensive tackles and pinched them in, anticipating the ball was going to be run right behind the center. And that looks like what? A timeout worthy by Brian Kelly and his defensive staff.
Well, Myron Tungavailoa-Amosa missed the Stanford game with an ankle injury, and Tua's cousin gets the stop. A tackle for loss on fourth down to flip the field for Notre Dame as Sebo Flemister is able to pick up a yard.
I honestly don't mind them going for it on fourth down there. I just did not like the fact that they were in the shotgun. I mean, think about it. You're hitting the ball off to the tailback 3 or 4 yards deeper than his goal or line to gain when you only needed a foot and a half.
Play action for Ian Book. Now he heaves one over the middle for Claypool inside the 10. Reaches the ball out at the goal line. They'll mark him down at the 1. One official says touchdown. One official says he's down at the 1 yard line. And now we're going to get a discussion. It is a touchdown for Notre Dame. Second of the game for Chase Claypool.
Commit to the run. Commit to running the football. Sometimes those 2 and 3 yard deposits pay off. A play action pass, you saw Claypool continue to come across the football field. He's looks like that left knee gets down there, but a great job of continuing to play for Claypool, crossing, and then Ian Book finding him. But that's set up by some play action pass.
Ruled a touchdown on the field. So there would have to be indisputable evidence to say that the ball didn't break the plane before his knee touched down. He's reaching that ball out as the knee touches the turf, so hard to imagine they're not going to stay with the call that they made on the field, but they are double checking to make sure. Worst case scenario, it's first and goal inside the 1 yard line.
And remember, it's if the ball, if any part of that football touches any part of that white line, right? If just the tip is touching it on the white, the front of that white end zone line, that'll be a touchdown. I think it's a touchdown. You got to credit that Notre Dame offensive line, too. There was a long time for Ian Book to hang back there and survey the field and find somebody. He actually had Fink wide open down the sideline, didn't see him. But just the ability to hang in there. And that's what Brian Kelly wanted to see out of him, too. Don't leave the pocket when you don't have to. Good job hanging in there and finding Claypool.
Yeah. After further review, the runner's knee was down prior to breaking the goal line play. The ball will be placed inside the 1 yard line. First down.
Well, I'm not sure which of the replays they saw in the booth. Certainly the ones that we took a look at didn't seem to be indisputable that Chase Claypool failed to break the plane of the end zone before his knee hit the ground. But again, worst case scenario, and that's what's happened here for Notre Dame, it's first and goal at about the 1 foot line. And both of these replays we're showing you here are synced. Again, the nose of the football just breaks the plane. It's a touchdown. And they say that Claypool didn't get it into the end zone, so it's first and goal inside the 1. Quarterback sneak for Book. Gets a shove from his mates, and he'll be short. It's going to be second down and goal inside the 1.
Really good job by Iowa State. Ray Lima at the point, making sure there was absolutely no push there for Notre Dame offensively. If I'm Notre Dame, I'm going to run to the perimeter. If you're going to commit so many people to put over the center's head, I'm going to run off the left side behind my 3 tight ends.
toss to Jafar Armstrong. He tries to turn the corner, does, and it is a Notre Dame touchdown.
Really good call by Notre Dame. Iowa State had committed so many people between the tackles to stop that internal quarterback sneak or inside run, pitch the ball out to the outside, and make it a race to the front pylon.
This to give the Irish a three-possession lead with 2:25 to go before halftime. Dorr knocks it through. It's 20-3, Fighting Irish.
Talked about the playoff games today. Well, you're going to see Joe Burrow have the opportunity to push the football down the field a ton, something he's had a ton of success with. They've got a bunch of big-time receivers, Ja'Marr Chase, Jefferson, Marshall, all of them are really good at going down the field and then crossing routes. That's going to be the biggest challenge for Oklahoma secondary. Joe Burrow throwing the football down the field to, again, the best wide receiver core in America.
Can you win this game if you're Oklahoma without blitzing? And blitzing effectively and blitzing high percentage.
It's interesting. I would actually do the opposite.
I would
play coverage. And I would dare LSU. LSU did not get to the number one seed and obviously have the season they did by running the football. Can run the football well, but that is not the absolute dominant part of their offense. I would play coverage. I would hope that our three or four man rush can spy a little bit and go, you're going to have to run the ball 35 times against us because we think we can score enough if you do that, if I'm Oklahoma.
It is a touchback for Iowa State and our first opportunity to check in. What's coming up at the half with Matt Barry?
Game bells into the end zone. It'll come out to the 25-yard line. That's where the Cyclones will have the ball first down and 10.
And we had an Oklahoma game earlier this season. You made a very interesting point. In spite of the fact that they rack up yards and points and they're an explosive production offense,
yeah,
they're not the kind of offense you would think they would be strategically. Like, if they fall behind, they're not built to quick strike the way you might think on paper they would be.
Not at all, because they're an offense that wants to be run-based. They want to control the line of scrimmage, kind of impart their will on you, run the football with Jalen Hurts and Sermon, and then get CeeDee Lamb the football, but it's not a chuck and duck all over the field and try to quick score through the air.
Purdy over the middle. Tariq Milton into Notre Dame territory. Picks up 28. How badly would Iowa State love to put the ball in the end zone before halftime? They start the third quarter with the ball.
Massive. And I love that throw right there by Brock Purdy. I love the play call. Getting him being aggressive to start this two-minute drive.
Terrific pass protection. That allows the crossing route to come free to DeShante Jones.
Both of those are just so well done by Brock Purdy. I always say this. Don't tell me if a quarterback can make all the throws. Make the right ones at the right time. You saw just him take a little bit of tempo off the football, get him up over defenders on both of those throws. Now, the big thing right now, you got a 1:57 left. You don't have to play at a crazy, frantic pace. The number one thing, Brock Purdy, don't take any sacks. Completions are okay. Let your guys go to work. And you can even try and pop a run at some point.
Play action. Purdy to the sideline to Petway. And he steps out of bounds with a gain of about 4.5. And Iowa State still has that one timeout as well, should they need it.
Good job getting that completion. I've seen Peyton Manning go two-minute drive after two-minute drive of all checkdowns. Hey, you want to just continue to play zone? I'll continue to take checkdowns. All of a sudden, 5-6 completions later, you've gained 60 yards, and now you're in the red zone. Okay, now we can come take our shots. Continue to get these completions, Brock Purdy.
Purdy's going to float one up the seam. Inside the 5-yard line for Sean Shaw. He's got it. It looks like he won the 50-50 ball. If it's simultaneous possessions like baseball, tie goes to the runner. The offensive player gets credit for the catch, and Shaw took it away from Pride.
Well, he's going to bluff the safety there, right? Okay, we're going to be quarterback run and then go down the field, and I love that Brock Purdy gave him a chance, an opportunity to go make that contested catch. Outstanding job by the freshman.
And now a false start. And I'm not sure why Iowa State felt the need to get up there and go quickly. 1:29 to go in the half.
Prior to the snap, false start, 74 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
And Dan, wouldn't you think getting up there, taking your time, not rushing, and also taking time off the clock to not allow Notre Dame to get a chance before halftime might be the better way to go?
They're in the potentially ideal situation as we see this catch by Shaw. Go up and make it. Go make the contested catch. We'll see a lot of that in the playoff by some of those receivers tonight. Outstanding catch. But yeah, Bob, to your point, this is the ideal situation. Chance to score points and not give the football back to Notre Dame.
Notre Dame still has two timeouts, so they may use them to try and save time for their offense. Purdy extending the play. And he's going to throw this one away through the back of the end zone. Being chased by Ade Ogundeji.
Good throw away by Brock Purdy right there. You see Matt Campbell trying to figure out what they want to go to, how to manage the clock. I really think that you put Charlie Kohler on one side, Notre Dame's going to put a safety in the middle of the field. So throwing the ball down the middle of the field is not ideal. Put Charlie Kohler on one side, Sean Shaw the other, but both six guys, and see if they can cross each other to create a high and low for Brock Purdy to feather a ball up over the top.
Purdy, back of the end zone, incomplete. Through the hands of Sean Shaw. Dante Vaughn, man-to-man coverage, and the Cyclone fans wanted a flag.
You see this ISO, Sean Shaw kind of trying to give a little bit of a one-step slant and go. You can make the case. It's not egregious. To me, that's not obvious. But you can make the case that there's a lot of contact between Vaughn and Sean Shaw right there.
They may have to call timeout. Iowa State late running players onto the field. Play clock's down to 5. It's down to 3. And Matt Campbell's going to have to call timeout. Iowa State was discombobulated there as they were running Chase Allen, their second tight end, onto the field with maybe 12 or so on the play clock. They just couldn't get set. So Big 12 now on ESPN Plus, a must-have for Iowa State basketball fans. The exclusive home to more than 40 men's basketball games, including the Cyclones taking on number 5 Kansas at Hilton Coliseum January 8th at 8 Eastern at the Farrell Center against number 7 Baylor on January 15th, also at 8 Eastern. Sign up today at ESPNplus.com/Big 12.
Not the great, you know, this is not, this time and situation has not been managed perfectly by Iowa State. They're not utilizing Charlie Kohler, though. I want to put Charlie Kohler to the, by himself, and force Notre Dame to put two people over there, because if they don't, throw it to him. And then if they do put two people over there, allow Sean Shaw, the middle of the field, to work. They've got to take advantage of the 6'6 Kohler.
We'll see if Iowa State gets tackled in the field of play on this third down and goal. Will Notre Dame use a timeout as they have two remaining? Two tight ends. Here comes a blitz. Purdy is going to throw one to the front right corner of the end zone. Petway was out of bounds. So now it's fourth and goal from the 9. And it looks like the field goal unit will indeed come out for Iowa State to try to get 3 before halftime. Notre Dame will still have 2 timeouts, and there should be about 50 seconds on the clock, even if Iowa State makes it, after they kick off.
And that's why it goes back to that first down. After the Sean Shaw downfield catch, milk that clock, force Notre Dame to make a decision to use a timeout or allow the clock to run off.
A sally from 25. So it's now 20-6 Fighting Irish.
And guys, for Notre Dame defensively, this is a win, right? That's what Clark Lee said. If they allow a team to get into the red zone, they hold them to a field goal, that's a 4-3 win for his defense.
if you're in the red zone and you're getting threes and not sevens, it is a tough way to go. And that's an eight-play, 67-yard drive that, again, produces only three.
The way it started so strong for Iowa State, you have the mindset, let's go score a touchdown. And to your point, Bob, getting the ball to start the second half. At the end of the day, the number one goal when you start a two-minute drive is to get some kind of points, especially at the end of the first half. So that is a successful drive for Iowa State to go get 3 points. Now, it's paramount for their defense to get off the field with no points, because you don't want to trade threes here with Notre Dame. Paramount for their defense to get off the field here and not give up any points to Notre Dame.
Braden Lindsey in the corner at about the 4 yard line. And pretty good coverage by Iowa State as they knock him out before he gets to the 25. Well, the college football playoff semifinals on ESPN and the ESPN app begin at 4 Eastern. The Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl. Joe Burrow, the winner of the Heisman and the quarterback of the number one team in America. LSU takes on Oklahoma. And then it's Ohio State Clemson in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. The winners, of course, play for the national championship Monday, January 13th on ESPN. And for Clemson, it may come down to whether or not you can block that guy.
He's Terrell Suggs to me from many years ago coming out of Arizona State. He's one of those guys that changes everything that you do. Every single play, whether pass or run game, what are we going to do with number two, Chase Young, to minimize his impact?
Ian Book with a middle screen to Tony Jones who dropped the ball. Notre Dame still has two timeouts and 41 seconds on the clock. And again, Iowa State will start the third quarter with the ball. Notre Dame won the toss and took the football to begin. And now it's Tony Jones on a run. So maybe Brian Kelly is happy to go to the locker room with a two-touchdown lead. Running it there, not calling a timeout. Iowa State doesn't have any timeouts, so if Notre Dame just wants to go to the locker room here, they can.
I'm a little bit surprised, you know, especially when you run the ball on second down and get 6 yards. You could call a third and four play and see if you can get a conversion, but Brian Kelly obviously very pleased with the first half. The offense has moved the football. They've created some big plays down the field. Ian Book's had a really clean half, and they've run the ball relatively well. So really good half for Notre Dame.
And they end the first half with a red zone stop as well. Iowa State fails to score a touchdown in the first half. Stay tuned. It's the Mercedes-Benz Halftime Report after the break.
One Bowl Mania.
Welcome back to the Camping World Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania here in Orlando. Just about set for the start of the second half between Notre Dame and Iowa State. Ian Book with a couple of big plays. Chase Claypool, one for a touchdown, and Notre Dame has a two-touchdown lead. But Brock Purdy will start the third quarter with the football. Bob Wischusen, Dan Orlovsky, Allison Williams is with us here as well in Orlando. We started the top of the show talking about how important this game was for Notre Dame. They're looking for back-to-back 11-win seasons. That hasn't happened since the late 80s. It seems like they're engaged. They have been an intense football team from the jump.
They've played really well, both defensively and offensively. You look at their defense and what they've done, suffocating Iowa State offensively, creating some turnovers, and making sure that Brock Purdy didn't get out of the pocket and make some plays. And then offensively, they wanted to run the football and take shots downfield. And they've done both of that, right? And so not only the execution, but the mindset of their players has stood out in the first half.
Matt Campbell, the Iowa State head coach, a moment ago spoke with Allison.
What are the biggest things that gave you confidence that you saw in that first half?
Well, I think you see our guys making plays. You know, you take about six or seven things off, and we're right where we want to be. And the fact of the matter is we got it to a two-score game, and I like how our football team plays in the second half.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Well, Dan, he's going to have a chance to see his offense go out there and make that statement stand up. They really need a touchdown to open up the third quarter, down by two scores. And he's right. They put up 204 yards of total offense in the first half. So between the 20s, They moved the football, but they couldn't get in the end zone.
A big thing for them, not only on this drive, but really the second half, is being more efficient on first down. They were in way too many third and longs, putting pressure on their offensive line and trying to find Charlie Kohler or Michael Petway amidst some pressure from Notre Dame. So being better on first down, whether it's throwing or running the football, to make sure you're a rhythm-based offense. This is an offense that is based upon its rhythm.
It'll be a touchback to start the second half. Out to the 25-yard line for the Cyclones. As we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. And the first 10 points of the game for Notre Dame were scored off of takeaways.
Well, you saw the fumbled punt return. Gilman rips it out, and Notre Dame takes that punt return and gets 3 points out of it to start the football game. And then Brock Purdy on third down is trying to make a play. Gets the ball punched out. Recovery by Notre Dame. And then that equals a touchdown for Notre Dame as he finds Claypool down the sideline against cover two. Big high ball. And that's the 10 points off those two turnovers. That really so far is the difference, not only scoreboard-wise, but feel of this football game.
They fake the tunnel screen, throw it over the middle, and it's incomplete as Purdy was hit just as he was trying to find DeShonte Jones. Allison.
Guys, Brian Kelly really pleased just overall with his defense's performance in that first half. He said we did a really good job of making them one-dimensional. Offensively, remember he said pregame he needed to see a better job with the physicality up front, winning at the line of scrimmage and finding an identity in that run game. And he felt like in the first half that happened. He said our offensive line has done a really good job in our run game and making sure Ian Book has enough time.
Well, Brock Purdy, conversely, has been hit 6 times. By the Notre Dame defense, and Breece Hall will spin for about 2.5, maybe 3 yards. So third down and 7 to start the third quarter for the Cyclones.
Another outstanding job by Drew White, the linebacker for Notre Dame, of just making sure he scraped to the football. And I talked about it coming out of this half. The third and longs hurt this football team. And what Notre Dame is doing defensively is going, we're going to kind of protect the middle of the field. All these crossing routes that Iowa State likes to do, take them away. And force Iowa State and Brock Purdy throw the ball to perimeter. This ball's got to go outside to start creating some conversions for this offense.
Blitz on third down. Purdy shot over the middle, and it's caught on the crossing route by Charlie Kohler, but he's driven out of bounds short of the first down. Troy Pride was there to make the stop. Now it's fourth down and 1. And here comes the punt group.
It also shows you the respect that Notre Dame has for a guy like Charlie Kohler. They take their best corner, Troy Pride, put him on him in a man third down situation, and just an outstanding tackle against the 6'6", 260-pounder.
Joe Rivera, spiraling kick, and a good one. Drives Fink all the way back on a bobble inside the 20-yard line, Dan.
Well, let's take a look at today's clutch delivery brought to you by my favorite food, Chipotle. You're going to see Claypool third down conversions, a little shallow screen, throwing the ball downfield, making some contested catches on a corner route. Book breaks the pocket, finds Claypool again every time. Watch him go high point this football. And then we saw the touchdown early on. Just outstanding athleticism, hand-eye coordination, go grab the big ball. Claypool, Chipotle, clutch delivery.
You know, you don't get free samples or anything.
You never know.
I don't know.
It's not going to hurt.
I've been reading things by Mercedes-Benz all these years. I've never gotten anything.
Chipotle, if you're listening, brown rice, double chicken and cheese.
There you go. Payola, we call that in the business. Well done, partner. Tony Jones gets down the sideline. Can he be caught? Tony Jones inside the 30. Uses the stiff arm. Inside the pylon, and he's in for a Notre Dame touchdown. What a run, 84 yards by Tony Jones.
Coming from the living room, watch Tony Jones. Patient stiff arm, great block blocking on the perimeter by Notre Dame. Look at the long speed as he's trying to outrun these Iowa State defenders. Be physical at the end. Stiff arm for about 12 yards. Outstanding big time effort by Tony Jones. What a way to start the half for the Irish.
Tavon Kyle, a 176-pound corner, caught up to Tony Jones, 224 pounds, and a stiff arm later. And it's seven more for the Irish. Can you feel the rush taking
over all your senses? Stream your favorite sports, stories, and series with ESPN Plus, Disney Plus, and Hulu. Get all three for just $12.99 a month.
Back at the Camping World Bowl here in Orlando, Bob Wischusen, Dan Orlovsky, and Allison Williams. Notre Dame, a three and out on defense as Iowa State tried to set the tone to start the third quarter. Well, the Irish flipped the script with a long Tony Jones touchdown run after their defense got a stop. And now the Cyclones are in a deep hole. And it will be a touchback once again off the kickoff. Back to the touchdown.
Let's watch a three-part block. Cole Kmet, first of all, you're going to go block on the number 11 safety, Lawrence White. Now watch Fink come in. The wide receiver is then going to go block up on the safety coming down. That's number two. Now let's watch the third part, tight end, Tommy Tremble. Now you get to go block the corner. That is outstanding design by Notre Dame. Great block by Kmet. You get the receiver blocking the safety. Then the 240-pounder Tremble blocking a corner. That's creating matchup advantages for your blocking scheme offensively.
And if Tommy Rees and Brian Kelly wanted to get back to the Notre Dame DNA of running the football, pretty good example there as Purdy shoots one over the middle and it's through the hands of Keshante Jones and incomplete. We met with Brian Kelly yesterday. He said, this is what you're going to see. You're going to see some play action, but you're going to see us run the football.
And go under center. He was like, listen, we don't see that a lot in college football. Ohio State does it a little bit, right? Go under center. We want to reestablish going downhill, try to gain some edges in our run game, which is exactly what we just drew, and then take some shots downfield. Now, a lot of coaches say that and then don't do it. They've committed to doing it today, and they're doing a really good job, and their players are rewarding their coaches for it.
Delayed blitz. And a check down to Milton for 5 yards. Third down and five now for Iowa State.
You see this change from the field to the sideline, sideline to field for Notre Dame. Getting more athletes on the field. They don't get this exotic blitz package. They want four rushers, sometimes five, but four rushers, and then they are going to play really what's known as a funnel defense. Outside leverage man coverage, funneling everything to the middle of the field where they have an extra safety waiting for some crossers. Iowa State's got to throw the ball to perimeter.
Purdy with a ball fake. He's going to try and run for it, and he won't come close. Three and out on the opening possession. Give up a touchdown, and now possibly a three and out once again for Iowa State as Khalid Kareem is down again for Notre Dame. It's the second time he's been injured.
And that play is exactly what Clark Lee, their defensive coordinator, that's his dream scenario. I don't really care about getting sacks off of crazy blitzes. I want to get sacks off coverage. That's exactly what it was. The lockdown coverage by Notre Dame. Look at all, there's his man coverage, two man, two safeties deep. Now if you're Brock Purdy and you break the pocket, nowhere to throw the football. Everyone's locked down, okay, you continue to try and be creative, move around. Guys trying to work, you're locked down, you're locked down, you're locked down, you're locked down, no one's open. Now you break it again, freeze it. Look at this plaster coverage by Notre Dame. That is really well done, that's hard to coach. It's hard to execute, but that is what Clark Lee wants. I want to get coverage sacks. Credit his players.
Let's take a look at what happened to Khalid Kareem as he was holding that left ankle. And when he tried to turn the corner on the pass rush, that right ankle there, pardon me, just got stuck in the turf. But talking to Clark Lee yesterday, it's funny. He said, you know, people call us vanilla on defense, almost like it's a little bit of a dig, an insult. He said, yeah, you know what? We're vanilla.
Yeah.
That's what we do. There's not a lot of mystery to what we do. We just have a belief and a plan, and it's kind of simple, and we want to execute it. And boy, have they done that today as a knuckleball punt comes out and takes an Iowa State hop down to Fink, who thought about fielding the ground ball and instead lets it roll dead down to the 22-yard line.
Well, the big thing about Clark Lee was controlling what the outcome of the play could be. If they execute you against you, that's fine, but he doesn't want this all over the place, not having an idea how the play could end.
Well, let's take a look at our more driven moment brought to you by Goodyear. And it's the last drive, Tony Jones. This was more driven right to the end zone.
Well, you saw a little bit of everything as a tailback here. Some vision, some patience, a stiff arm, some long speed down the sideline as you're getting chased by all 11 for Iowa State, and then at some point stick that stiff arm out there, and I want that end zone more than you. That's big time by Tony Jones, the redshirt junior out of St. Petersburg, Florida, IMG Academy, who's had a nice season. He needs more touches, and he's paying off today with some big time runs. Offensive line doing a really good job, tight ends doing a really good job, but great finish by Tony Jones.
Book off play action, and finds the crosser in Cole Kmet. And Kmet out to the 45-yard line. You know, when you run it well, all of a sudden that play action frees up the tight end for a gain of 23.
And listen, no one likes cool and fun and creative offensive plays more than me. But at the end of the day, football is about running the line of scrimmage. And when you commit to running the football and making those small deposits in the run game, not every run's going to be 12 yards. 1 and 2 yard runs can pay off if you commit to it and you're starting to see some play action stuff. And this is when, as an offense, you feel in complete control.
End around to Lindsey. Gets a block. And gets driven down after a 2 yard gain. Greg Eisworth made the stop. Eisworth, one of four Cyclones to be a first team All Big 12 selection on defense twice. He was first team All Big 12 this year.
He's a stud, Eisworth. Hopefully he gets healthy. He's been banged up this year. Get healthy next year, he'll be one of the best players in the country.
Book to Claypool. Tough to bring down. Mike Rose stopped him just short of a first down, so it's third and one.
Claypool's going to be fascinating, you know, coming out for the draft this year. He's 6'4", 230 pounds. If he runs somewhere in the 4.5s, it's going to be hard for him not to be a very early pick because of his ball skills as well.
Designed run for Book. Stopped. It'll be fourth and one. Ray Lima in the middle of the pile for Iowa State. And with a 27-6 lead, it looks like Brian Kelly is going to play it conservatively here and send out Bramblett to punt.
I agree with this call. I mean, the last thing you want to do is breathe life into a football team, really an offense for Iowa State that is struggling right now with a short field and a big play. Make them drive the football field on your defense, who's playing outstanding, and earn their points.
Tariq Milton lets it drop. And it takes a hop into the end zone. It scoots past Claypool. So it will come out to the 20-yard line for Iowa State when we come back.
The Camping World Bowl on ABC is brought to you by AT&T.
SOCOM Paracommandos landed on the field here at Camping World Stadium. This was their view pregame. Pretty cool. Bob Wachus and Dan Orlovsky, Allison Williams back here at the Camping World Bowl in Orlando. Eighth Iowa State possession of the game. Once they started at their 33-yard line, the other seven have all started at either their 25 or worse. They'll run here with Breece Hall. And he will get to the 25-yard line and pick up five. So putting it on their defense, controlling field position, just playing kind of an old-school Notre Dame game. That's what the Fighting Irish have done very well today.
And Brian Kelly's got to be ecstatic with seeing that. I mean, this is the program that he wants, the program that is absolutely back in national picture and that he thinks is very close to catapulting towards that next step, playing physical football, running it, taking some shots, and playing suffocating defense.
Purdy, incomplete, into traffic for Jones.
Notre Dame just doing a really good job of placing their defenders exactly where Iowa State wants to throw the football. That's what Clark Lee's game plan was, knowing that they throw crossers so much. When we play zone, we're going to make sure that we're putting our zone defenders in the places or the zones that he wants to throw, and it's creating these third downs. And that's when Notre Dame's decided, okay, we're going to play a ton of man coverage. You're watching Kyle Franklin play man-to-man on the big tight end and forcing difficult throws.
Purdy sidearms one to Petway on third down. And that's a big third down conversion for Iowa State. They pick up 17.
It's really one of those bunch rubs or meshes that they worked with early in the first quarter. You got Petway in man coverage, use Kohler as a rub or a mesher, and just that 1 yard of separation is all Brock Purdy needed. Now you got to get this drive going, get some momentum and rhythm going for your offense.
Purdy gonna float one, man to man. Looking for Wilson, incomplete. Flag out. Troy Pride covering Darren Wilson, and Wilson may have drawn a pass interference flag.
Pass interference on the defense, number 5. Penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Troy Pride's going to the Senior Bowl. Interesting, though, when Clark Lee told us he's got legit long speed, but ball skills sometimes have to be worked on.
And I think this is a legit call. Watch his left arm reach right there. Kind of like slingshots himself. You talked about the speed, Bob. He's got so much going. Use that left arm, just that tug, and he got caught. It's a good job as a defensive back. It's a good job if you don't get caught because it's so kind of hard to see, but that's a legit call right there.
Purdy out of the pocket again. Has a man wide open, doesn't see DeShonte Jones, tucks it under and runs for about 4 yards. DeShonte Jones slipped behind the coverage, and Brock Purdy never saw him.
Watch DeShonte Jones come that shallow cross right there about the 43. He's going to slip upfield and go, and Brock Purdy's got him. He's got him right there. Throw the ball downfield. He's about 2 yards behind that line of scrimmage. Continue to keep those eyes downfield. That's the big play that this Iowa State offense needed quickly.
Here comes the blitz on second down. Wide receiver screen to Breece Hall. So the running back steps out and takes a little hitch and picks up 5, third down and 1.
But that's a really good play. You know, the biggest thing, one of the things that you can do as an offense is if a defense is going to continue to pressure you, you have to show them that you have answers for that pressure. And sometimes it's not a home run 80-yarder. 4 or 5 yard screen pass tells the defense, we've got some plans for your pressure, and allows the 3rd and 1 here. This should be 4 down territory for Iowa State. This should be a tackle, a run off the right side of their offensive line.
Purdy slips one down the sideline. This time he does hook up with Jones. And that's going to be good for a first down. And if Jones stays in bounds, he might score.
I would say might have gotten away with one right there. Petway's blocking. There's that recess football from Brock Purdy right there to gain that conversion.
Now Breece Hall. Brought down right at the line of scrimmage. Drew White made the tackle. Purdy has been flawless this year in the red zone, but they've been kicking field goals rather than getting in the end zone in this game against Notre Dame. Now you'd have to think it's 4 down territory all the way through. I'm not sure a field goal does much of anything for Iowa State.
There's no doubt about it. And you've got a one-on-one matchup at the bottom of the screen that you could take advantage of with some size and Sean Shaw.
Play action. Purdy extending the play to the sideline. Shaw can't hold on. It'll be third down. Just inside the 20-yard line, third and 10.
Watch Sean Shaw. He's trying to get a little double move here. Puts his foot in the ground to come back to the scrambling quarterback and falls down, and Brock Purdy's got nobody. But Iowa State needs, they're trying to continue to hit these crossing routes. It's not happening. Notre Dame will not give it to you right now. You've got to go to something else. Make the adjustment. They're not going to give you what you want first. Go to your second and third option scheme-wise to allow Brock Purdy a little bit more success.
Purdy under pressure and down he goes. Sacked back to the 25-yard line. Ogun Deji collapsed the pocket. And now if you're Matt Campbell, you probably just take the three. What other choice do you have?
Good job by Notre Dame making sure they get one-on-ones on the outside. We talked about Julian Good-Jones, their left tackle not being in. Kniffel's left one-on-one against Notre Dame premier pass rusher. Big sack, and now you kind of have to kick this field goal if it's, as it's fourth and 16.
Yeah, the down and distance now, from a percentage standpoint, compels you to try the field goal. This to cut the lead, though, to 18. Still a three-possession lead, even if you make it for Notre Dame. And Asali puts it through. Under five to go in the third quarter. Nothing but field goals for the Cyclones. And they're down 27-9. If Oklahoma is to have any chance to pull off the upset against LSU, you have to think CeeDee Lamb is going to be a major factor for what they do offensively.
Absolutely, and it's not only going to be through the air. I mean, he's such a difficult guy to bring down. They'll hand it off to him, some jet sweep, and so LSU is going to have to make sure that they're going to tackle CeeDee Lamb and to counterpunch against LSU to score some points.
It's the college football playoff semifinals today on ESPN and the ESPN app. Joe Burrow and LSU will take on CeeDee Lamb and OU in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl at 4 Eastern. And it's Ohio State Clemson in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. And then the national championship game will be determined. Who will meet Monday, January 13th on ESPN? We're going to find out this afternoon and tonight. Short kick. And a fair catch made at about the 15-yard line. So Lindsey will have it come out to the 25. Back to Matt Berry. All right, Matt, thanks very much. And Iowa State fans are still hoping Brock Purdy will arrive before the end of this game as Ian Book and the Irish have it back with a three-score lead. Bob Wischusen and Orlovsky and Allison Williams and Jafar Armstrong. Looks like he might have a first down on that carry. Nope, they'll mark him down just shy. A 9.5-yard gain on first down.
Bob, watching Ian Book throughout the day, you can see he's just in such command of this offense. And it's really been a year of growth for him with his maturity and his confidence. Coach Kelly said beginning his career as a backup, he didn't have all that pressure, all that noise around him. He was just kind of playing with house money. This offseason, he's the guy, right? Everybody's talking about him being the next great Notre Dame quarterback, and he didn't really have the ability to defuse that. He internalized it. Well, after the Michigan game, he said it was a crossroads for him. He came, he sat in Coach Kelly's office, and he's like, where are we at? And Coach Kelly told him straight up, you're our guy, but you have to have confidence. He said, if you don't have the confidence to play quarterback here, you're not going to be the quarterback here. We believe in you, but you have to believe in you. And it was really a turning point for Ian Book.
And you know who was as impactful was Tommy Rees. He said Tommy Rees in that moment was so important for Ian Book to help him, to use Allison's word, diffuse all that noise, shut out everything from the outside, and realize you were the quarterback at that school, and what everybody else outside of the building thinks of you doesn't matter. And Tommy Rees, I think that was a really big moment for Brian Kelly to go, this guy's transitioned from being buddy to coach.
Book on second down. Finds a crosser. That's the tight end, Tommy Trimble. And he steps out of bounds with a first down at the Iowa State 45-yard line. Well, Dan, there are certain glamour positions, not just in college football, but in all of sports. I mean, being the quarterback at Notre Dame is on that list. And normally, it's a kid who's 19, 20, 21 years old. You're the center fielder for the Yankees.
Yep.
You might be on the young side, but you're still a pro. You've done it for a long time. Being the quarterback at Notre Dame, when you are still what old dopes like me would refer to as a kid, as Armstrong bounces it outside, that's hard.
Well, I think the biggest difference between being a quarterback at Notre Dame in comparison to some other schools, not all, but some others, is there is not a day that goes by that you are not talked about.
Right.
Whether you're talked about positively or negatively, there's not a day out of the 365 within the year that your name is not in conversation in print, on social media, on radio, on television, some capacity. And when you have some success, you start, okay, this is easy. I'm feeling myself a little bit. And that is a dangerous mistress to start to take in.
Helps to have a run game. Jafar Armstrong lost 4 yards on first down, got back nearly four on second down, so it's third down at about 10.
And that's also sometimes when we talk about players and quarterback position, we always tie it to the maturation on the field. We never tie it to the maturity off the field and handling those things. And that's what Ian Book has kind of transitioned to in the last couple months of this season.
Give these Cyclo fans credit as well. They know third and 10 is a play where their team needs a stop, and Claypool is not going to let them get it. Tunnel screen works to perfection, and Claypool drags tacklers down to the Iowa State 25-yard line. Took Marcel Spears for a ride.
Can't say enough good things about this Notre Dame offensive line. Get out in space, make some blocks, and then look at Claypool. I've mentioned his size, but how about the effort today? This is a guy who plays special teams as a graduate. You see the first down point. NFL's coming, and they're going to love stuff like that from Chase Claypool.
Book's going to take a shot for Claypool in the end zone. Incomplete. Jump ball, good coverage from Daytron Young.
Guys, I think you can see why Ian Book is looking for Claypool there. I mean, look at the end he had to the regular season. In November, 8 of his 12 touchdown receptions came in that month. That's more than any other Irish receiver has for the full season. And Claypool said a lot of it is just the relationship and the chemistry with Ian Book. He said, I wish the season started in November because the chemistry we've developed has just accumulated throughout the year.
Here's Book to Chris Fink. And Chris Fink has been the beneficiary, according to Brian Kelly, of all the attention that goes to Chase Claypool and Cole Kmet.
Kmet took three people with him on that play. Just running a 8-yard in route, three guys for Iowa State are caught defending Cole Kmet, and Fink's got no one near him. Your word benefactor is exactly right, and it's a good job by Ian Book not forcing the football and finding the open guy.
Play action. Book looking for Lindsey at that front right pylon. It'll be second down and goal at the 5.
I actually like that play by Ian Book. Try to get a little pop pass. It's not there. He hung in the pocket. Okay, now I got to break the pocket, throw the football away. I still have a second and third down. Cole Kmet on the inside, and then you've got Claypool on the outside. You're probably going to get some kind of, that's Kmet, there's Claypool. You're going to get some kind of zone coverage, might hand it off.
Book will try to do it himself, gets a block, and he's out of bounds, just inside the 2. It'll be third down and goal.
You can tell that Notre Dame down here is trying to get the ball to the perimeters. Iowa State is committing so many people into that box. We saw the pitch out before in a goal line situation. Cole Kmet is up top, one-on-one.
Instead, Book looks left on the slant for Claypool. And now it's fourth and goal at the 2. And it looks like Coach Kelly will take the 3.
I don't mind Ian Book going to Claypool right there, but if you're going to go to him in that route, it has to happen right now. You can't catch and read. It's got to be a catch and throw. And if not, you had Cole Kmet one-on-one up top. throw him a ball that's up high where only he can go catch it and let him outjump the defender.
Jonathan Doerr, a chip shot. Try and make the lead three full touchdowns. And he's got it. 15 seconds to go in the third quarter. And Book knows that he just missed one as Bowl Mania rolls on Monday. Two more games on ESPN and the ESPN app. We'll have Western Kentucky, Western Michigan in the Serve Pro First Responder Bowl at 12:30 Eastern. And then Kylin Hill, Mississippi State, against Scott Satterfield's Louisville Cardinals in the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl. That's coming up on Monday as Capital One Bowl Mania rolls on. And then on Monday night, it's the Capital One Orange Bowl. Kyle Trask and number 9 Florida against Bryce Perkins, number 24 Virginia, Hard Rock Stadium in Miami, 8 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. Doerr with another deep kick through the back of the end zone.
Well, how's Notre Dame shut down Charlie Kohler, the second team All-American? Watch how they drop where he's going. Put people in the zones where you think guys are going to be outstanding. A linebacker underneath, a safety driving over the top. Nowhere to throw the football but Brock Purdy. Now down in the red zone again. Kyle Hamilton on the outside. The other nickelback sitting on the inside. That's the zone that they want to throw the football and not allowing it. That is exactly, to a T, how you shut down a big-time tight end. You allocate two people to him. You can still play zone coverage and make sure you know where they want to throw the football. Place a guy on the outside and the inside or underneath and over the top.
Here's Breece Hall. 9 yards on first down, and that should take us to the end of the third quarter. Iowa State needs a heck of a fourth quarter rally. What they need to do is find the end zone for the first time, and they will try to do that when we start the fourth quarter here at the Camping World Bowl in Orlando in just a moment. All right, Matt, thanks very much. And he won the Heisman going away with record-setting numbers in terms of yards and touchdowns.
I mean, besides the yards and touchdowns and numbers, the most impressive thing is every single time that he's had to step up throughout the season and make a play in a crucial moment, he's made it. Did you see the shooting contest the other day?
Yes.
That he hit 13 of 15 or something like
Soft
that?
Soft rim.
Oh, there we go. He's wired like that, it seems, where he steps up in big-time moments.
No question. If you're in the NFL and you put up 4,000 yards, that's a nice season. Got 4 less games to do it in college, and he still did it. Breece Hall, jump cut up the middle, and he's able to move the chains and pick up about 6.
We've all gotten to see just how impressive Joe Burrow is as a quarterback. Well, Oklahoma's Lincoln Riley saw it when he was in high school. In fact, Riley was telling Holly Rose covering the game that he thinks he might have been Joe Burrow's first scholarship offer when he was the offensive coordinator at East Carolina. And another cool connection between the two, Riley actually coached against Burrow's dad when he was the defensive coordinator at Ohio University. So he definitely knows them very well.
Backwards pass. Breece Hall wanted to throw it downfield. And instead, once again, look downfield, as Brock Purdy often has today, Dan, and sees bracketed receivers and nowhere to throw the football, has to run out of bounds, and lost about a half yard.
I guess the best word to describe this Notre Dame defense today has just been discipline. I mean, the discipline that they have played with, not only understanding what their role is on that play, but the eye discipline has been very impressive, and so that's a credit to their coaching, but also their players to understanding the game plan and not falling asleep in a fourth quarter up 30-9 in a bowl game.
Breece Hall being stretched and loses yards back inside the 35. Owusu-Koramoah cuts him down, a loss of six, and now it's third down and 17.
Just the instant penetration by the Notre Dame defensive line forced Breece Hall to try to push that ball outside, and Owusu-Koramoah is just too athletic. And this is, I mean, what do you draw up here for third and 17? Kohler's going to be taken away. You got to try to find LaMichael Petway maybe on an in-breaking route away from Kohler.
Four-man rush. There's the in-breaking route. Deshaunte Jones, he's going to get bottled up and have nowhere to go at the 40-yard line. He got seven, but it's going to have to be another punt for Iowa State. 2 minutes gone by in the fourth quarter. They're down by 21, and they will bring out the punt group.
Seven on the play.
Clark Leach just had a great afternoon. He's had a great afternoon of devising a game plan and then figuring out what they want to do, and we're not going to let you do it.
Offensively, defensively, special teams. Can you think of one glaring mental error that Notre Dame has made today? There's always execution errors
sure.
at some point, but have they made one dumb mistake?
No.
I can't think of one. They have been so solid in all three phases. And Fink, inside his own 10-yard line, goes out of bounds at the 9. 2.5 gone by in the fourth quarter, and the Irish have the football back. Back in Orlando, take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. And Ian Book has been efficient, Notre Dame has been efficient, and they have taken advantage of any mistakes that Iowa State has made.
Yeah, I mean, that's the name of the game. Certainly, at least to start, is mistakes by Iowa State and Notre Dame capitalizing on those mistakes. And then Notre Dame started second half, got off the field on a 3-and-out, had the long touchdown run, and it just has felt like almost a boa constrictor, like they are going to suffocate you as a football team and not allow you any room to wiggle.
Well, this is a team that's going to lose Chase Claypool. They may lose Cole Kmet. He has an NFL decision to make, but they're going to return the vast majority of their players. Sebo Flemister gets about a yard and a half. And that's why Brian Kelly talked about this game as a tone setter for next year, because he feels like the recruiting class he's got coming next year, to go along with what he'll still have as the core of this group, this could be a top 10 team to start next season.
There's no doubt about it, especially with the quarterback Ian Book coming back. And talk about a recruiting, like, Brian Kelly thinks that they can become a top 5 recruiting program. Right now they're about a top 15 recruiting program.
Screen out on the edge to Fink.
And to become that top 5 recruiting program, he's got 11 coaches. He's giving every coach out of that 11, one out of 11, a cultural fit for the program of Notre Dame. Then their job is to go find kids that fit that cultural fit, that's designated to that coach, and their number one job, get them on campus. He said, if we just get them on campus and we get two of those kids on offense, two of those kids on defense, we, and they're 4 or 5 stars, we come for top 15 to top 5 or 6, and then the program really takes the leap all its fans wanted to.
Iowa State rushes 4 on 3rd and 5. Book checks it down to Tony Jones, and he's double-teamed out in the flat and brought down. Tavon Kyle got there first. So it's a 3-and-out, and this should be by far the best starting field position for Iowa State when they get the ball here. They have not had a drive start at better than their own 33-yard line.
And I know this score is 30-9, 21 points, but Iowa State is the number one scoring differential team in the fourth quarter in the country. They scored 20 in the fourth quarter 4 times. So a team this year that's certainly used to this situation, that's got the capability to do it. So Notre Dame needs to make sure that they lock in and finish this football game.
Line drive punt, and a fair catch made by Tariq Milton. Looked like he could have caught that one on the dead run and ripped off a return. Still, plus territory for Iowa State.
The Camping World Bowl on ABC is brought to you by Camping World, making RVing fun and easy since 1966. And in part by Capital One, what's in your wallet?
Notre Dame scored their first 10 points off turnovers, and then they controlled the line of scrimmage on a long Tony Jones touchdown run to start the second half. Extended the lead to a point where it might be too deep of a hole for Iowa State to dig out of, but by far their best starting field position of the day. At the Notre Dame 46, Brock Purdy, well protected, floats one down the sideline, trying to toe tap as DeShonte Jones. He did not, could not get a foot down. So it will be second down and 10. Bob Bischusa, Dan Orlovsky, and Allison Williams here in Orlando. Iowa State, Dan, they may only get the ball three more times. So now they have zero margin for error.
And again, down 21, the run game is gone. You're going to have to throw the football almost every play. And so that's the challenge right now, is continuing to try to get some kind of rhythm offensively, but only doing it with one aspect, and that's the pass game.
They may take another look to see if DeShonte Jones toe-tapped. It was very close. He may just have gotten the left toe down.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Before he went out. Let's see.
Watch the left foot. Ball caught. I think it's a catch.
I think it is too. It looked like the left foot also touches just before the right foot comes down. Boy, that is so close.
That's outstanding camera work. I think that's a left foot down catch. Ball is already being caught in that moment. To your point, Bob, left foot goes before the right foot. Only need one in college football.
Iowa State hasn't had much go their way today. They may be due, as DeShonte Jones, who has four 100-yard receiving games this season, may have just made a terrific first down catch.
And that's a ridiculous throw by Brock Purdy, and it's an even more impressive catch by DeShonte Jones. It's great coverage by Jahmyr Jones for Notre Dame, 44 with the left hand in there, and just the ball placement and then the wherewithal to get that left foot down or try to. That is truly toe, tap, drag, swag.
And it looks like we've got a decision.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands of an incomplete pass.
Iowa State can't buy a break today.
I respectfully disagree with that. I thought it was pretty clear on video that that was a catch.
I think the head coach may have gotten word from the replay booth, at least the monitors his assistants were looking at upstairs, that he looked a little dumbfounded as well. So an incomplete pass. Now it's second down and 10.
Find a soft zone. Notre Dame's playing some soft zones on the perimeter.
They're going to run it with Jones. He picks up three. Owusu Koromoa makes the stop for Notre Dame. It'll be third down and 7. Coming up on 10 minutes to go. And for Iowa State, you think maybe a little sense of urgency here as well. Pick up the tempo. They need three scores. And now we're inside of 10 minutes remaining.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost 25, 30 seconds since when you snapped that last football. Like, you got to get going here. Clock is your enemy right now if you're Iowa State offensively. They got into this bunch so many times and used rubs. Look at that combination for this offense.
The Irish show blitz. A screen pass out in the flat to Breece Hall. Gets a block. And it'll be fourth down and 1. And a no-brainer go-for-it situation for Iowa State. Jalen Elliott made the tackle for the Irish.
They got to play with more tempo. You got to get going here. This can't be a situation where you're constantly looking at the sideline here. I know it's fourth and 1 and you want to get in your ideal play call, but this should have already been decided before the end result of this play if you're the Iowa State coaching staff. This ball should go to the perimeter, truthfully. They've tried up inside a bunch against this Notre Dame defensive line unsuccessfully.
Purdy running out of options, running out of time, and gets sacked by Owusu Koromoa. And Purdy gets up with a limp as he is hobbling off the field. We are back with today's Capital One Player of the Game, and hard to argue with Chase Claypool. 7 catches, 146 yards, a touchdown, and one he was robbed of when he got it all the way down to about the half-yard line. And it was eventually finished off by Notre Dame's offense. So easily could have had two scores. And he has used that size, Dan, and athleticism at times to dominate the game today.
And I think that today's effort puts him over 1,000 yards for the season. Obviously a great way to end what has been a really good career at Notre Dame for Claypool.
Ian Book dives ahead for five.
I'll go back to this. You know, Claypool obviously had a great day, but this is a really big day in performance by Tommy Rees as well. I mean, this was an opportunity for him to show Brian Kelly, I can be your play caller.
Book out to Fink. Breaks a tackle. And how uncharacteristic this is as well for Iowa State as we take a look at Brock Purdy heading back to the locker room. Turned his ankle, and this on that last fourth down attempt when he was sacked.
See Owosu, Koromoa, excuse me, just get rolled up on that left ankle right there. Certainly hope Brock Purdy's fine.
Lemister into the line. Got to go back. 2017 is the last time Iowa State lost a game by more than two touchdowns. Since that time, Oklahoma, Washington, and the Cyclones, the only three teams in college football not to have lost a game by this lopsided a score. Their average losses in the last 15 under Matt Campbell, they only lost by 5.7 points. And this season, heartbreaking losses to the two best teams in the Big 12.
Iowa State, they're first.
So we certainly did not see this coming.
I mean, you asked me what do I think. I said, this is going to be a fourth quarter football game. That's both of these teams' DNA.
We'll step aside for just a moment. Iowa State played six one-score games this season. Five losses by a total of 21 points and three of the real heartbreakers. The rivalry game with Iowa by a point. Lose at the gun. On a Baylor field goal by two, and then against a college football playoff opponent, they go for two and lose by one to OU. So this is an Iowa State team that has played the top teams in their league and one of the best teams in college football right down to the wire, but just not to be today for Matt Campbell's group, as this will be their most lopsided loss if the score holds. Going back to 2017. Play action for Ian Book. Wants to screen in traffic to Tony Jones. It'll be third down and about eight.
The best thing that you can say for Iowa State right now is the effort is there. It's not surprising with their head coach Matt Campbell and the culture and program that he's built, but the effort is still there even in a bowl game. Notre Dame checking to the sideline, sees pressure. This is either going to be a one-on-one ball down the field or some kind of screen to counter this blitz by Iowa State.
No deep safeties for Iowa State. They do bring the blitz. And it's an easy pitch and catch first down to Cole Kmet. So the Irish move the chains. And Allison, we unfortunately saw the Iowa State quarterback move to the locker room. What do you know about Brock Purdy?
Yeah, tough to see Purdy get injured there. They were looking at his left ankle. The good news is, guys, a teammate brought him over crutches to help him get to the locker room, and he shook him off and said, no, I can walk. So he was able to walk off on his own power.
It'll be first down and 10 for the Irish.
Looks like Cole Kmet may have gotten rolled up on that last play as well. He comes off the field, but seems like he's in much better shape than Brock Purdy was in. Jones down to about the 17-yard line. Let's take a look at Cole Kmet and that last tackle.
Watch him just get rolled up underneath. He's already got a sleeve on that right knee, right leg getting folded up underneath there. Kid with a very bright future. Hope and pray.
Notre Dame tight ends this season collectively as a group 11 touchdown catches, six of those by Cole Kmet. It's the most ever touchdown catches for that position group in Notre Dame history. Jafar Armstrong is brought down. Back outside the 20-yard line for a loss of 3.5. Jake Hummel a little slow to get up. Or check that Hummel on the stop. That's Wazirike a little slow to get up. Third down and long for Notre Dame. It's a shame on a national stage for Iowa State that they are underperforming the way that they have today, because this is a program with Matt Campbell at the helm that has been really good. And there's Fink drilled at the 20-yard line, so presumably Notre Dame will try to kick another field goal. Mike Rose made the stop. Tonight after Ohio State Clemson, stick around for SportsCenter with Scott Van Pelt. PlayStation Fiesta Bowl postgame coverage will lead the way. Plus a look at the college football playoff championship matchup. We'll know it by then. And highlights some of the association's best teams in action tonight. The Lakers, Clips, and Bucks all playing at SportsCenter with SVP after the Fiesta Bowl on ESPN and the ESPN app. Dorer puts another one right down the middle. 33-9, Notre Dame on top. Flag down.
Running into the kicker on the defense, that penalty is declined. Result of the play is good field goal.
So if Brian Kelly took that penalty, it still would have been fourth and relatively long. He leaves the points on the board. And you got to give the kicker an opportunity to safely come back down. That's Tavon Kyle, who's flagged. Well, fans, you can tune in on the ESPN app for the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One. That will be immediately following our coverage. Head over to the ESPN app, and the hardware will be presented to Coach Kelly and the Fighting Irish. Nwangu from a yard deep. Out of bounds at the 24. Driven out by Troy Pride. So with Brock Purdy back in the locker room, looks like Rayon Mitchell will take over at quarterback for Iowa State here with 3:46 to go.
Guys, we've been talking just about what a clean and like disciplined game this has been for Notre Dame, and credit to them for locking in, because that's not how it was to start the week. Coach Kelly, not too pleased. Some of the guys stayed out late. They didn't have curfew Tuesday night, so they were out too late. You said they showed up a little sluggish and groggy the next morning, but since then, much better. And this is a team, he says, that really loves just playing for each other, and a good example of that. After the game, they had the option. We can get the charter, and we can head home, as it looks like Notre Dame will get the ball back here. And they chose to stay. They could have gone home. They could have gone back to Notre Dame. This team wanted to stay in Orlando and have a team party together and celebrate this season.
And Dan, what does that tell you as they get another takeaway? So with 3:29 to go, it will be Notre Dame football again. What does that tell you about the culture with this group that Brian Kelly has built?
They understand that college football is really special.
Yep.
You know, I mean, you don't get that in the NFL that often because so many guys come from different families and whatnot, that college football is very special, that they enjoy being around each other and love the kind of the camaraderie of it. And it was important for them to finish this season and for a lot of the senior class the right way. This is one of the better senior classes in a long time at Notre Dame. We've talked about their success with the 10-win season. This would be their third 10-win season in a row since 91, 92, 93. So it shows me a lot about their character and their commitment to the program.
The officials got together and changed the call, saying that Charlie Kohler was down, that elbow right there before the ball popped out. So It will be second down for Iowa State. They give the ball back to the Cyclones. And on a keeper, it's Real Mitchell. Brought down right at the line of scrimmage.
Going back to the staying after and having the time together as a football team tonight, Brian Kelly pointed out two things for this really senior class. The consistency that they've done things at, and then also understanding that there is a process that's the buzzword process, but that process is very difficult. Process is something that is hard to do every single day, especially at a place like Notre Dame. They have to grind athletically and grind academically, and the consistency of them doing that is what Brian Kelly is most proud of.
High throw, incomplete for Petway, so it'll be fourth down and five. And it looks like Matt Campbell, with his backup quarterback in the game, and the game decided, it's going to wave the white flag here and send the punt group out.
Still coaching, though. Matt Campbell still coaching. What did you see? Talk to me about what you saw there in that bunch concept, not taking, you know, the moment and taking the opportunity to make sure he's coaching the young quarterback, Real Mitchell.
Rivera with a spiraling kick. Fink back to his own 20-yard line. And gets taken down. Landon Akers with a nice tackle on special teams after a 51-yard punt.
Fink's for sure going to go and get drafted in the seventh round by the Patriots. He's going to have 65 catches a year and beat up on the Jets, right?
That's usually the way those things work out. Does he have some kind of an odd, like, lacrosse background where maybe he's never played football before and Bill Belichick will turn him into an all-pro?
He's probably a try-hard kid, coach's son, knows where to line up. Gym rat. Truthfully, he's a really good route runner.
Phil Dracovic will come in and take over now at quarterback for Ian Book with Sebo Flemister at tailback. Hand off to Flemister, gets to the sideline, and easily picks up a first down. Michi Walker runs him out. And now, Notre Dame can go to victory formation if they like. Assuming Iowa State's not going to use their timeouts on first down, this will take us inside of 2 minutes to go. They're going to keep on running plays with the backups in the game, but if Iowa State does not call their timeouts and Notre Dame takes the play clock all the way down, they can end the game. Flemister again, student body right. Now close to the 40-yard line, close to another first down. And this is exactly the kind of complete performance Brian Kelly was hoping to see from his team. A tone-setting game for next year.
And this stuff matters. It really does. How you finish your season, not only with a win or a loss, but the way, how you feel about your football team and your program moving forward. We've talked about the style of football that they wanted to play. Running it and controlling the line of scrimmage. Getting back to that. Now you've got a great way to end your season. You're an 11-2 football team heading into your offseason of winter workouts and whatnot, and the expectation and the standard level for the program has again gotten another stamp on what is and who are Notre Dame football in right now, in modern day college football.
And next year, the Irish, as part of that group of ACC games that they will play every year, they've got Clemson on their schedule next year.
No way. That'll be fun.
So that'll be a really fun game to watch, especially if Notre Dame is what we think they're going to be. They play well in the early portion of their schedule. I believe they've got Wisconsin as a big one early on, much the way that they had Georgia early this season. And who knows, if they are what we think they could be next year, that game with Clemson,
awesome,
will be a clash of the Titans. Notre Dame, they win the Camping World Bowl in convincing fashion over Iowa State.
Take care of everything.
Allison's right here.
For the first time since the late 80s, Notre Dame is a back-to-back 11-win team. This is capping their third straight 10-plus win season, and Allison is down there with Brian Kelly.
Thank you guys very much. Coach Kelly, pretty dominant performance here today. What are you most proud of with this victory?
Well, obviously, Iowa State's a really good football team. For us to keep them from scoring a touchdown, that's a pretty good offense. But that's been our defense all year. We had a great season. We had one bad day. But our kids bounced back from that, have won six consecutive, and it's a really good football team. It's a group that loves to play together. They don't listen to what other people say about them, and they just keep playing hard. And offensively, I thought we did a great job today of being opportunistic, ran the ball effectively, and Chase Claypool continues to be a big-time player for us.
You mentioned that run game, and that was a focus for you this afternoon. You wanted to find that identity again. Yeah. Did you see that?
We did. We were physical today. We had, obviously, Tony Jones's big run opening up the third quarter was huge for us. I think it just it gave us that shot, that confidence that you need when you can control the line of scrimmage. I think all of our guys felt like, you know, the game was in their hands. And our offensive line, I think the coordination of making sure that everybody had a hand in what was going on out there today. We had receivers blocking tight ends. Really good performance by our football team.
This gives you 11 wins for this season, and I know it's a senior class that's been special to you. What do you think their legacy will be at Notre Dame?
Well, 33 wins over the last 3 years. There's not many programs. There's probably just a few that have done that. And the consistency of performance, setting a standard that's that high in college football is very difficult. They can talk about being an elite football team. Yeah, we have not won a national championship. That's the next step for this team, but they have put us in that position now that we can take that next step.
Coach Kelly, thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Congratulations to Notre Dame. For Allison Williams and Dan Orlovsky, I'm Bob Wischusen. Up next, the Capital One postgame trophy ceremony on the ESPN app. We'll be back after these messages. As we welcome you back to the trophy ceremony here at the Camping World Bowl, presented by Capital One. And it is a deserved celebration for the Fighting Irish, as in all three phases of the game, they were dominant today against Iowa State. 33-9 was the final. Bob Wischusen and Dan Orlovsky upstairs. Allison Williams about to anchor the trophy ceremony downstairs, but we talked about it throughout the game, that this was a tone setter for next year for Brian Kelly. It looks like he got what he was looking for.
Absolutely. Not only the end result, right, but the style of play that they had, the way they controlled the football game, they ran the football, their offensive line, which has been beat up this year, played really well. And then Ian Book was the distributor. When he does that, this offense can play with anybody in America. And Brian Kelly mentioned they had one bad day this year, their loss on the road against Michigan. So this is a program and a team that absolutely is one in the conversation for one of America's best. And now they will take this and springboard into winter workouts and recruiting, get a bunch of people back. Ian Book will probably become one of the more numbers-wise successful quarterbacks in the history of Notre Dame throughout next season, and they'll be in the conversation as a top 10 program.
Yeah, they'll be talking about this team next season as maybe being in one of those games coming up this afternoon or tonight, as we have our Capital One rewarding performance and the names that a Notre Dame fan wanted to see perform at the top of their game today. That's what they saw. Here's Ian Book to Claypool.
Stars show up. Book to Claypool, which started their scoring touchdown-wise, and then Tony Jones, a long, physical, violent touchdown run to open up the second half. And it was a little bit of everything. Everybody had a part in this football game and the dominant performance by Notre Dame. Brian Kelly obviously did a great job this week of handling everything, getting his football team ready to play. They're well coached. They've got a great culture and a bunch of really good players.
And Allison is down there, set to hand out some hardware.
Thank you guys very much. Yes, we are ready to hand out the hard-earned hardware here for Notre Dame. All right. right, thank you guys so much. Before we get this presentation started, I want to thank the fans from both Iowa State and from Notre Dame who came out here to support their teams and really made this a special atmosphere for everybody today. Thank you. All right, to start the ceremony, we have Ken Robinson, president of Florida Citrus Sports, and he's going to present today's MVP award. Ken.
Thank you, and congratulations to all the fans that traveled down. On behalf of Florida Citrus Sports, I'd like to award the MVP for the Camping World Bowl to Chase Claypool. Well done.
Seven receptions today, 146 yards and a TD for you. It was part of a pretty dominant performance from your Notre Dame Fighting Irish. How were you guys able to be so successful today?
None of this is possible without our defense showing out every single day. That comes to our starting defense, our scout defense. You know, they give us tough fits, so when we come out here, you know, it kind of seems easy. So it's all credit to the defense.
Credit to your defense, but offensively for you, heck of a finish to the regular season. You carried it into the bowl performance. What was different for you from November on?
We just started having fun. You know, that's what we preach every single day, and as soon as we started having fun with it, you know, we started playing our kind of football. So,
Coach Kelly was saying that this group, they just love playing for each other, playing together.
Yeah.
They don't care if a trophy's involved or not. Yeah. How much more fun is it when there is a trophy involved?
I mean, yeah, it's definitely nice. Gives us some memories and stuff. But like you said, we do it for every single one of us, and it's for our brothers.
How big is it to be able to send out the seniors this way to end out, you know, the season with a win and help this team going forward?
Yeah, no, I keep saying it, but I think the most exciting thing of my career is when the seniors can get on the field and finish their career here. So we were able to do that with a couple of seniors and send them off right, but you know, I'm happy this season ended off well.
Awesome. Chase, thanks for the time. Congratulations. Chase Claypool, your MVP of today's game. What's that? Just a minute, one more minute. We got more hardware to hang out. All right, next up we have Tamara Ward, Chief Operating Officer of Camping World, who has a few remarks before presenting Coach Kelly with the trophy. Tamara.
Great, thank you. First of all, thank you to the Iowa State fans and the Notre Dame fans that came out for the Camping World Bowl. We are very much appreciative for everything that's done. The weather held off for today. It's just been great. But now let's get to some hardware. Coach Kelly, appreciate everything that your team has done for the game today. It was just wonderful. Great young men that you have here for yourself as well. And we would like to congratulate you and award you the 2019 Camping World Bowl Championship Trophy.
Congratulations to Notre Dame, the 2019 Camping World Bowl champions. Again, for Allison Williams and Dan Orlovsky. I'm Bob Wischusen, so long from Orlando, back to the studio.
Except for all these people.
We're
going to
bring it down there.
Oh, just call you, Chase.
Jeremy, where are you going?
No, get off the stage. We're going to take your trophy down there.
Thanks, guys.
All right, Coach Kelly, I love how much you guys just want to celebrate this win.
They
you can
do.
See how much it means to them. How special is it to get this 11th win in bowl victory?
It's special for them because all that they have done this year is focused on playing the game without the achievements attached to it. They just love playing with each other and a brotherhood that is hard to break. You know, we concern ourselves so much with, you know, what's the gratification? You know, what do you get out of it? They don't care. They couldn't wait to come down to the Camping World Bowl because they got another chance to play with their brothers. And that's what I loved about this football team. I've coached for 30 years. This is a unique blend of young men that that just enjoy playing with each other, and that's a great thing for college sports. It's clean. It's one thing that for me as a football coach, you really love getting these opportunities.
You just mentioned that word clean. It was a clean game today.
Yes.
By your team. What impressed you most just about the discipline with which they played?
Yeah, the attention to detail was outstanding, and we really focused on it. The traits of excellence for us are about that attention to detail, having a great attitude, the focus that they have. They play really smart, and they live by those every single day. And so they carry that onto the football field, and you can't win 33 games over the last 3 years unless you have those traits, and they're a remarkable group.
Coach, congratulations on the win.
Thank
Enjoy
you.
The party tonight
we
back
will.
At the hotel.
We're going to have fun. We're going to stay in Orlando. Orlando's been good to us. Every time we've been here, the next season we've gone undefeated. So we hope that happens again.
All right. Good things to come.
Thank
Looking
you.
Forward to it. Thanks, Coach Kelly. Thank you all for watching the Camping World Bowl post-game ceremony. Have a great night and a happy new year. We'll be right back.